day the best and the greatest. Wow, 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 wow. What a morning. And I really don't know what to say exactly, actually, based on the events of last night, the clarifications of last night, which were quite extraordinary. So, anyway, we will set the tone. We can always set a tone, can't we? Even if we don't know exactly what words to say. The weather here is very cold. Rainy, stormy, cold, unusual. But I'm out here anyway. I got a heating pad to try to keep me warm. So, blessings to everyone here. Because we are all... blessed, for sure, for sure. Now I will call this video the bottle cap video, the bottle cap video, and I'll tell you why. Because I had this dream, and I was in the kitchen looking for there was a bottle. A plastic bottle on the countertop, and I was cleaning up the kitchen in the dream, and I saw the bottle, and I said, oh, okay, where's, I need to put the cap on it, where's the cap, and I didn't see the cap to the bottle. It's one of those, you know, screw-on caps, and I was in a hurry. I had a lot of stuff to do, and so I was just going quickly, briskly. And I said, there's no cap. And then my mind said, well, I don't have time to look for a cap. I don't know where it is. It could be anywhere. I don't have time for that. So I'll just imagine a cap there. And instantly, there was a cap, perfect cap right next to the bottle. I took the cap, screwed it on top of the plastic bottle, and then put it away in the fridge. So I was done with it. Okay. Now, I was aware of this, and I woke up with awareness of this. This is the most significant dream I've ever had, and all it was imagining a bottle cap. But I was able to put it into context and understand, like, what did I just do? So it's a lot to explain, and it's actually self-evident, really. Truth is self-evident. It's completely self-evident. So no explanation is required. When you see, when you recognize it, it'll be completely self-evident to you. It was just at imagining a bottle cap, and bing, the bottle cap instantly appeared right next to the bottle. So it's easy. Instantly. But I was aware that I had imagined it into existence like that, into its presence there, its appearance. I was aware of that. Now, I've never had a dream like that before. And so this awareness enabled me to recognize. When I woke up, I began to look at this and generalize it and realize what had just taken place and what does it mean. And it really is, it's difficult to really explain if you don't see it, if it's not self-evidency. How do you explain what is self-evident, what is evident to the self, obvious? But you might say, if I can find some words, I have to come at it from a different angle. So, this little bottle cap dream, the bottle cap dream, just set off a recognition in me. Sparked a recognition in me. The recognition, self-evidency, sparked self-evidency. I said, ah, wow. And it was self-evident what the teachers, the Dharma kings, have been telling us. It became self-evident. But if I get into trying to explain it, it will seem to kind of muddy, sort of muddies it a little bit. You have to be very careful about explanation, about what's self-evident, because then it becomes less evident, doesn't it? It becomes less evident. So you may have a awakening like this, where, as simple as that, a bottle cap in a dream. So it could be anything at all. And you just become aware, say, hey, I just imagined that. I wanted that to appear, and it instantly appeared. That's the power of mind. That's mind doing that. I must be mind. My mind just did that. And it becomes self-evident. The power of mind becomes self-evident to you. Okay, so what happened was that the mind became self-evident to me. It became evident to itself. The mind became evident to itself. So mind recognizing mind, you might say, took place. Now we use mind the way that the Eastern traditions might say self, or different traditions use different nomenclature. I use mind because, to me, mind means creative aspect. We were created. God is mind, means creativity. And all creativity is fresh, untouched by any other creativity that's ever taken place. This is very important. This became self-evident. I say, I'm mind. And nothing that I've ever imagined or created has any effect at all on what I want to imagine or create now. It's untouched. The mind is always untouched. There's no conditions for the mind at all. All creativity is untouched by all other creativity. So creativity is always fresh. There's no conditions at all, prior conditions at all. And no, the creativity we have now does not create prior conditions for later creativity. But again, this became self-evident. So it cannot be explained to someone. What we should do is prepare for the experience of self-evidency. So this wow practice that I've been doing, obviously, this has prepared me for the mind to recognize mind. That's how effective it is. And that's what happened. That's what happened. And I said, wow. Okay, wow. And then, what do you do? Get your breakfast. What you do? Take a shower, get your breakfast. Ooh. A huge flock of small birds just... The wings, you hear the flutter of their wings, and they just suddenly came in, settled upon a tree right here. Oh, there they go right there again. Wow, the birds are on the wing right now. So, the flock suddenly came in. Huge, a big flock quickly came in. Isn't interesting? So what we're really after is not explanation, but the capacity to handle self-evidency. The nature of mind is self-evident to the mind. There's one mind, and we are all aspects, creative aspects of that one mind. And the one mind works in the same way for all of us. And there's no such thing as conditions to the one mind. And since the one mind is all there is, there are no conditions at all. Everything we think are conditions is just the creativity imagination of one mind, but the one mind is never touched, conditioned by imaginary conditions. Never conditioned. Just like the sun shining may imagine clouds, but the clouds don't obscure the sun at all. They don't condition the sun. But But this, again, is self-evident. It becomes self-evident. So what we really need to practice is prepare for self-evidency to dawn. And this flattening of all evaluations with just wow. This obviously, for me, is the key. It's the key. And so just by doing that practice, breakthroughs will continue. The mind will be trending more and more towards accepting the self-evident nature of mind. It will trend in that direction. The spiritual path is just a trending in the direction of mind, recognizing mind, that there are no conditions for mind. Mind is free. Everything it imagines is fresh and perfect in the now. And it's never creating conditions. The mind cannot create conditions for itself at all. Cannot. So all what we think are conditions is just the imagination of mind trying to create conditions for itself. But it cannot. It cannot. So there are no real conditions at all. It's just illusions. Illusions seem to have effect on other illusions. But illusions are not coming from themselves. They're coming from mind. And the illusion is the belief that they're a condition for the mind. Nothing is a condition for the mind. The lack of a bottle cap there was not a condition for the mind. Not really. Because what condition can there be when the mind can instantly imagine anything it likes? How can it be said the mind is affected by conditions? Now, I wanted something to be a certain way, and it was. Ask and ye shall receive. And I understood to give is to receive. This became self-evident. The mind never receives anything except what it gives. Giving is instantly receiving. I gave myself a bottle cap, and there it was. I received it. There's no conditions getting in the way at all. So instantly, to give is to receive. There's no dynamics or conditions at all. The mind is not under any conditions. This became self-evident. The bottle cap dream. Now don't try to figure this out. Just hear the tone of this. Hear the tone. Feel the tone of this. Self-evidency. Self-evidency. It's frustrating if we try to figure it out. I've been barking up this tree for a long time, but it took this little bottle cap dream to sort of bring it into focus better. I said, oh, that's mine. That's my mind. That's the mind. That's what I am. And really, if you really explore this, you see that there's no conditions at all. No such thing as conditions. That means atoms. There's no atoms, electrons, none of that stuff. Those only appear to those who believe that there are conditions. Those who believe there's conditioned existence imagine all this illusion, imaginary conditions, that think that everything has to work according within those conditions. It's all imaginary. I was thinking about photography. Some good photographers. I know someone is a really expert photographer. And I was imagining if I was talking with him, I would say, well, I'm not as good as you, because some people just have the knack. They have this photographic eye. We could take the exact same picture in the same place, and yours would feel like alive, or some, it would feel, and mine would feel, no, it wouldn't, you know. And I've noticed this. And why is that? Because the observer influences the observed. This is Heisenberg's, I think, a principle. It might be Heisenberg, or it's a quantum physics principle. The observer influences the observed. But actually, it's more than that. The observer, how is the observed, you might say. We're always just observing our own creativity, actually. But because we have engaged in a vast collective effort of doing this, it seems as though it's difficult to talk about, isn't it, in a singular way. So we use an analogy of photography. But really, I saw that the whole scheme of materiality is just completely imaginary and only arises for those who want to believe in conditions. In other words, are there atoms? No. It's imaginary. That's just decoration of spaciousness. Electrons, structure, form, all that stuff is entirely our own imagination. And for those who are not trying to imagine conditions, there's no atoms, there's no form, there's no structure at all. There's imaginary appearancing, ornamentation of spaciousness. But there's no, what you would say, conditions at all. Chemistry, everything is direct to the mind that's self-evidently mind. It realizes everything is arising in the now directly. It's not arising through any process at all, or any conditions at all. So, no, there's no laws of physics, there's no laws of chemistry, there's no laws at all. When Jesus says we're not under the law, that's what he's talking about. He didn't just mean the Old Testament restrictions on you can't heal on the Sabbath. No, he was meaning way more than that. He came to free us from the law. I mean, all these laws of nature. There aren't any laws of nature, actually. There are no conditions at all. Mind is creatively imagining all of this right now. It imagines time right now. It imagines physics right now. It imagines chemistry right now. But mind is completely untouched by all that, and its next imagining is completely fresh and not touched by any imaginary conditions at all. And it's always that way. So this now is fresh and clean and pure, as it always is. This is self-evident. This is self-evident. There's not some thing, conditions that need to happen for this to be so. It's self-evident. Right now, it's self-evident. But the process of thinking is not self-evidency. That's the imagination, imagining conditions, the condition of evaluating. We need to evaluate it in order for it to be so. Now, there's no evaluating required for truth to be true. God, the one mind, is eternally free. And all creativity, everything it imagines, in no way does that restrict or put any valuing on any other creativity that can ever arise. All creativity that arises is always perfect, perfectly untouched by anything else that's ever arisen in creativity. And it all shares this quality, right? Unconditional quality. We call it unconditional love. There's only unconditional love, unconditional freedom. It's not that there's freedom free of conditions. There have never been any conditions. Imagining conditions doesn't condition the mind at all. They are not conditions for the mind at all. And this is self-evident. It's evident, obviously evident to the mind. It's not evident to imaginary conditions. Okay, it's evident to the mind. Self-evident to the mind. Also, the mind says, oh, so this is what I am. And don't struggle to try and put this into the world too much, because this is a vast collective effort of many aspects utilizing the imagination of the creativity of the mind to imagine that there are conditions. And so don't play that game. You know, don't play that game of complexity. Strive for self-evidency. So in that dream, I didn't... ordinarily in a dream, you would imagine a bottle cap to be there, and then, but in the dream, you would say, oh, there it is. How did I overlook that? That's weird. Okay, and then put it on the bottle. See, that's in the past, that's what I would have done. Say, huh, I was looking all over for that bottle cap, and it's right there. That's amazing. I'm a stupid. I overlooked that. It's really stupid. So we believe that the mind is stupid, actually. We claim self-evidency is stupid. But in this case, I was aware that my will was that, I'll just imagine a bottle cap there. That's a lot easier than trying to search around for one. And boom, there it was. And then I recognized immediately that my imagination had given rise to that bottle cap. So it wasn't like I said, oh, it's there all along, I just didn't see it, how stupid. No, I said, no, I put it there. With my mind imagined it to be right there. So it's this self-honesty like that. Self-honesty leads to self-evidency. Self-honesty leads to self-evidency. And this is a big deal. It's really a big deal. Huge deal. Yeah, self-evidency. Mind recognizing mind. Mind accepting mind. That's what we're after. But it never comes through a process of conditions. It's never conditioned. It realizes that the mind realizes, hey, wait a minute, no, I did that. There wasn't any condition that did that. I did it directly. And then it says, I'm doing all this directly. I mean, you start to realize, hey, everything I see, I'm directly responsible for it right now. There's no conditions responsible for this. I am responsible for it. That's honesty. So that kitchen, I'm responsible for that kitchen. The bottle, I'm responsible for that. I'm directly responsible. Not indirectly, directly. Now, the fact that many aspects of mind, call it spirit, is... They're all agreeing that they too will see that kitchen. They will imagine that kitchen too. This collectively imagining the same experiencing, the same creativity, and then claiming that this is some inevitable condition of creativity is dishonest. There's no law of creation that says if we all imagine the same thing, that becomes a condition for us. There's no such thing as that at all. But we have just imagined that we could usurp, you know, being the prime creator by doing this, by claiming that's some sort of, the mind is now has a condition, that we just created a condition for the mind. You know, if we all believe in matter, that means that makes matter real. No, it's still just a play of our imagination. So I've never really believed in matter. You know, the science. I've never really believed in science. I say that's their make-believe. You know, they want to believe in it, so they want to believe in atoms. Lo and behold, they find atoms. They want to believe in electrons, they find electrons. They want to believe in electricity, they find electricity. Whatever they want to find, lo and behold, there it is. Just like I wanted to find that bottle cap, and lo and behold, there was the bottle cap. But they're being dishonest by saying, no, it was there all along, I just couldn't find it. No, it was not there all along until you decided that that's what you wanted to find. So I, since I wanted to see the bottle cap right there, bing, bingo, there it was. Now, was it there all along? No. It was only appeared when I decided I wanted it to appear. Just like materialists want to see a world appear, want to see atoms appear, lo and behold, atoms appear. They want to see a universe appear, lo and behold, a universe appears. To them, as their creativity. But that doesn't condition the mind. That doesn't taint any other creativity than mind. Lo and behold, the mind wants to see something else, it'll see something else. So the mind thinks it believes it's a condition of materiality, of atoms and electrons and stuff. This is just complete make-believe. And we don't know what to do with it, which is fine at this point. I'm just bringing this up here as a kind of like a practice to just feel this. I say, wow. But don't try to analyze it. I'm just kind of spontaneously talking, not in a way of analysis so much, really. Don't get into analysis of this. It's too heavy because the collective nature of this effort to condition the mind is. You know, that will take a while to get free of that. It's easy to see it for yourself, but then when everyone else is involved in this collective effort to try and condition the mind, it's a little more difficult to generalize it perfectly, right? So we're not trying to generalize it perfectly right now. We're just making a start here. The Dharma Kings have generalized it perfectly. So they're not bothered by the fact that so many of us believe there's a world here. That doesn't bother them at all. You know, it's not an issue for them. But for us here, thinking we're in this world, it's difficult. So we don't struggle with that. But just kind of hear the principle of it, like, wow. Again, there's no difference between me desiring to see a bottle cap and it appearing as me desiring to see a world of atoms and electrons and molecules having that appear, and cells. There's no difference at all. Was the bottle cap that I imagined, is that made of electrons and atoms? Or is it just made of clear light and the mind desiring to see it? Is it really made of anything except the imagination of the mind? Does it really have to be made of anything, some condition? No. It's just its essence. It's the essence of mind. It's not made of anything. We could say it's made of clear light or essence, but that's kind of meaningless. We cannot speak of it in materialistic way, actually. We just try to put it, presume to explain it, but then that explanation itself gets put into a materialistic context, and then we get confused. You see? So it needs to be self-evident, and we need to get used to self-evidency. If I wanted the bottle cap to vanish, it would vanish. So what happened to the atoms and electrons of the bottle cap? What happened to its form? It was never a form. Really, all the whole energetic notion belief in conditions is just imagination. And you want to see it, so you see it. You want to believe in it, so there it is. But again, that's still just mind, a creativity of the mind, which in no way conditions any other creativity of the mind in the slightest bit. So mind is inherently free of all its imaginings, and never is it tainted at all. So there's no taint to remove. There's nothing to purify. Everything is inherently pure. I gained like 4 pounds because I ate almost half a pizza. I've been eating a lot lately. I felt tired. I felt like I needed to eat a little bit. The Holy Spirit even told me, eat some pizza. So, okay. But now I have to take the weight off. But sometimes you need to eat a little bit. You feel that way. And then sometimes you feel like, no, I don't need to eat so much. It depends. I guess the way the quote-unquote world is going now, I wanted to have a little bit of food in me, just sort of to calm me down, because obviously we're going into a very, there's a new sheriff in town, you know, which can be good, but you know, there might be some gunfights because the gangsters are trying to take over the town. They don't like that. You know how the Westerns go, where there's been this weak sheriff in town who's really corrupt, and so the gangsters who are moving into town to racketeers to extort from all the businesses in the town, which is what the gangsters do, extortion, easy money for them, right? They can just spend all their time gambling and whoring and they're extorting everyone, so they just get all this free money. Well, it's called racketeering. They love weak sheriffs. So we've had a weak sheriff in town for quite some time, and the gangsters have moved in, and they set up shop. They say, this is great. And finally, the townspeople get together, like in a Western, and they go to a really strong person who's not afraid, and they say, please come in and be our sheriff. You know, we're being terrorized by these gangsters and we know what to do. So a new sheriff comes in, deposes the old sheriff, and says, boys, we got a new sheriff in town here. Now, that's a Western. That's you know, one of the main themes of Westerns is this play of crime and law and order and how that plays out, how we want that to play out. And so John Wayne, you know, comes in, he's a new sheriff in town, and says, hey, you know what? Your racketeering days are over. And of course, the racketeers, they don't like that. They say our free money is coming to an end. We might have to work. And so they hire shooter gangsters to go after the sheriff. And there's always the guy in the black hat who's lives on a ranch outside of town who is funding the whole thing, right? So he has the money. The money's going to him. All the racketeering money's going to him, and then he distributes it to his thugs. And then he has money that he pays these thugs to get rid of the sheriff. And so then the sheriff gets some sturdy townspeople to help him out, and then there's gunfights happen. Gunfights happen. That's the Western. And people love Westerns, right? I mean, come on. It's like, finally, you know, finally the town is going to be rid of these really shady, terrible characters, extortionists, bringing in every kind of vice possible for their own degenerate amusements. So we've got a Western going on. The world's always got a Western taking place. And you got a new sheriff in town, and the new sheriff in town is a shooting sheriff. And the gangsters, the racketeers, they're shocked. What? What's going on? At first they're like really shocked, like, I don't know what the heck, what's going on, huh? And then they get furious, you see. We can't have that. That's interfering with the good life for us. And so then the Western develops, right? You get Clint Eastwood coming in, John Wayne, you know, these new sheriffs in town, Gary Cooper, you know, those are the guys that ride on the white hats and say, you know, new sheriff in town, and we're going to do things differently now. And all those money people serving the gangsters, make, you know, the whores and the gamblers and all these things that were getting money from the thugs, the racketeers. There's a whole industry comes up around pleasing the racketeers and their desire for a decadent, soft life. They don't like it either. They say, hey, you know, I just make a lot of money off these people. and so you have this whole economic thing that you know, of decadence that comes into play. And so a lot of people don't like the shooting sheriff. They're ruining our town, sheriff. But this is, you know, these are Westerns. This has been going on for a long time. It's one of the main motifs of the drama plays with movies. And there's the ones that are getting bribed. All the ones getting bribes from the racketeers. The mayor's getting bribed, of course. And the councilmen are being bribed by the racketeers to, you know, just tell the people, no, everything's fine, everything's legal, no, there's no legal, you know, nothing we can do, you know, and we're doing our job, you know, to kind of pacify the population. They bribe all these politicians. It's called lobbyists, you know, bribing. And the new sheriff comes in and says, hey, you know, you're taking money, you're being bribed, so you're out. And, you know, they get real skunky about it. So we got all that going on. So I felt like I need to eat some pizza. It's like, here we go. This is like the part of the movie. Okay, here comes the, you know, the shootout. And the whole, here we know, it could last a long time. Sometimes the Westerns, it lasts, you know, 45 minutes or something. I mean, the barricades get set up. You know, there's multiple confrontations of every type. And so time to get the pizza and popcorn out. So I did. I've been eating popcorn too, popcorn and pizza, because you know this is the part of the movie where things get a little jittery. The good news is my knee is not terrible today. I did a lot of workout yesterday, and it's holding up. Basically, it's not fine, but it's holding up. Yeah, so all the racketeers in the world, they're like getting real nervous right now. But it's all much ado about nothing, because there's no conditions for the mind at all. We are the mind. There's only the mind. And the mind is inherently free, untouched by its own creativity. Its freedom remains untouched from all the creativity. So there's no way it can create anything that has any effect on anything else it wants to create. Get this, okay? There's no way the mind can create anything that can have the slightest effect on anything else it wants to create. So the mind is this peaceful bliss of knowing this. It can do no wrong. The mind can do no wrong at all. It's trying to do wrong, but it can't. They wanted to see, can I do wrong? So this great collective effort of trying to do wrong, and it can't. So there's no conditions that the mind needs to get free of at all. This is the Dzogchen point of view, Longchenpa's point of view, Longchenpa apex array, apex yoga point of view, Jesus' point of view, Dharma King point of view. There's no conditions. I need to do nothing. I need to do nothing. There's nothing I need to do. I'm already free. There's nothing that I've ever been bound by at all. I've never been bound. But this dawns as self-evidency in the now. So you could have a bottle cap dream any moment. You don't know, right? I mean, it just Just in the flow of cleaning up the kitchen. I said, ah, I got no time to search for a bottle cap. Bingo, there was the bottle cap. I said, I'll just make a bottle cap. I'll just decide there's a bottle cap there. And there it was. But there was awareness of this and honesty about it to catch this and say, hey, this is meaningful. This is the mind at work. And no difference between the bottle cap appearing and anything else appearing. So the mind in seeing a world goes through all sorts of steps, kind of stepping down into hellish belief in conditions, such that ultimately we end up believing the perceptions of a body of eyes, but we're really just interpreting that as an excuse we're using. Really, the eyes aren't really seeing, the brain isn't really seeing, nothing's really seeing except the mind. And it's an excuse we use. It's sort of a dishonesty. And we think we're seeing matter. Oh yeah, it's matter. And that all matter conditions other matter, meaning the creativity of the mind, we believe is being conditioned by what we call nature. That nature is just, but there's no such thing as nature. It's just one more creative imagination of mind that doesn't touch the mind at all. So if it doesn't touch mind at all, what is it touching? Itself? There is no itself to anything. It's only mind. All creations are created by mind, and nothing conditions mind at all. So everything that's created doesn't have its own self nature at all. It's all mind nature. There's no nature nature. There's only mind nature. And mind nature, again, is never conditioned. So therefore, how could anything be have conditions? Claim to have conditions. Upon what? Upon what? Now we think upon other conditions. But everything the mind creates is free of everything else. So what, how could it have conditions at all? Truthfully, there's no conditions at all. Conditions don't exist. Conditions don't exist. Condition existence doesn't exist. There are no conditions. That's why we don't need to do anything. There's nothing to get free of. And this is the Dharma King, Apex Yogin, Dzogchen. Focus. There's nothing to get free of. Which is why graduated endeavor is just perpetuating the delusion it seeks to get free of. Because there's nothing to get free of. It's seeking to get free of something. And that's the mistake. That just perpetuates the mind's delusion that there's something to get free of. No, that's not self-evidency. Self-evidency shows the mind recognize there's nothing to get free of. I've never created conditions for myself. I can't. I cannot create conditions for myself. That's the realization that mind recognizes. I cannot create conditions for myself. It's impossible. So that's what we focus on here. The mind cannot create conditions, and only the mind is creative. Okay, so therefore, there cannot be conditions. Pretty simple, right? Only the mind is creative. There's no other creative force whatsoever. Mind is all creative. That's God. And mind cannot create conditions for itself at all. Therefore, there cannot be any conditions. It's inescapable reasoning. Oh, blue sky, it lives. See, the storm tried to say great conditions, but up above the storming, the sky was still completely blue, wasn't it? Beautiful. That's nice to see. kind of showery today, so they'll clear up, and then some showers will come in. But it's supposed to be snowing like heck in the Sierras. Another couple feet of snow. It's like almost already an all-time record snowpack. The drought in California is virtually gone. I think there's no more extreme drought. There's severe, small amount of severe drought, a little bit of moderate drought, and the rest is no drought. So it's there's a little bit in Santa Barbara area, that kind of area still. Kind of a bubble there. They need desalinization in Santa Barbara. Because of its location, it just seems to miss the southern storms and miss the northern storms. They have a desalinization plant. They just need to crank it up again, and they may work on brackish water and then piping that, something like that. They could do that. But the snowpack is just, I don't know, I don't worry about measuring it. It's just absurd almost. It's so much, and it's getting huge amounts more over the last several days. But so we're happy with the rain. It's not a problem. We put up with it. I was talking to someone yesterday. They're playing golf and today, and he said, if it's raining, he's not going to play. I said, and he said, we're Californians. We don't play golf in the rain. We're not so desperate. We have to go out in the rain. We get sunny days, virtually every day of the year. It's beautiful. Why should we go if it's raining? Why should we go out and play in the rain? First, forget it. Tomorrow will be beautiful. We'll play then. That kind of thing. Yeah. So, we're not desperate for good weather here. So he said, I like playing. Forget it. And I said, that's a good idea. I like that. Because playing in the rain is a real drag. It's fun if you just want to have fun and sloshing around. And I mean, if you're just out there to have fun with the elements, then it's great. It's a great excuse to be a kid again, sloshing around the mud and get all wet and. It's, oh, I just was playing golf. That's why I'm soaked. My shoes and it's fun that way. But if you really want to have a good golf experience, then it's not fun at all. It depends what you're looking for. But I used to go out in storms. I loved it. Yeah. Went out in a storm where the rain was going sideways, and it was amazing. Trying to see how can I play in this. It was like the worst conditions imaginable, and. It was like almost impossible to play. It's unbelievably difficult. But I did it. That was fun. I didn't care about my score. It was just a fun adventure. Like, how can you move around in this kind of weather? But yeah, I mean, a nice change of pace that if you want to do that, sure, it's a good change of pace. People like weather because it's differing situations arise, seem to arise. All an illusion, though. No different conditions arise for the mind because no conditions at all arise from for the mind. One mind, which cannot create conditions for itself, therefore, there are no conditions. There are no conditions. There never have been. And all we have to do is accept the self-evidency. This becomes self-evident, obvious to the mind. The mind just recognizes self-evident. That's it. There's nothing else to recognize. There's no conditions that need to recognize that there are no conditions. If there's no conditions, how could conditions recognize this? We keep waiting for conditions to recognize that there are no conditions. That's the delusion that we need to see through. All right? I mean, need to. Go to self-evidency instead. So the Dzogchen teachings and the Dharma King teachings is this self-evidency. Truth dawns as just self-evident. self-evident truth that dawns. Not any condition truth dawning, it's self-evident truth. It's not that it dawns upon us that conditions have finally understood that there are no conditions. How's that possible? If there are no conditions, how can there be understanding coming from conditions? And again, we try to explain this to conditions, and it doesn't work, right? So we think, it's so difficult. If there are no conditions, how can we explain anything to conditions? This is my smoothie of the morning, which is basically, since I gained up all that weight with the pizza, it's time to go low-cal. So it's just blueberries. Massive amount of frozen blueberries and fresh blueberries, tart cherry juice, and chocolate protein powder, and that's it. Time to shrink the stomach back. It's tough yo-yoing like this. I tried to stop it, but like I said, it's the time of the Western where the shootout begins. Yeah. Time of reckoning for the racketeers. And at first, only a few brave townspeople welcome the new sheriff. The new sheriff comes in and they always meet opposition, right? There's a morality play of corruption, how it works in the world, Westerns. And a few brave townspeople say, "Welcome, sheriff, we're with you." But the rest are saying, "Sheriff, I don't know, you're going to bring trouble to the town, you know." They get used to being extorted. And yet, deep down, they don't like it. You know, they say, I wish we could get rid of it, but I don't know. So they're kind of nervous about the new sheriff. And as soon as the new sheriff starts winning some of these fights with the racketeers, they start saying, "Hey, sheriff, you know, we love you, man. You're great. We're all behind you." Because they realize, hey, we can stand up to these racketeers. You know, we really can do it. And also the storm and the cold weather. I tend to eat more almost like that when it gets nice and warm. And if you just drink some, you know, drink a lot of water. Don't need to eat so much. But this the weather shift here was quite extraordinary, really. I mean, it was really warm, 78 degrees, tropical, like Hawaii. It felt like Hawaii here, and now it is, you know, it feels like snow almost. Hibernation response, eat a lot of pizza. I didn't need to, but God tipped me off, says, you know, I was aware of that and said, go ahead, go get some pizza and get that feeling like you ate something good, and now you can feel, start backing off of that whole thing. Back to the blueberries. Going back to the blueberries. Because when the gunfight starts with the racketeers, you feel like you might need to jump in and help out, and so you want to feel strong. You want to. bulk up for the battle. So there's this kind of response of bulking up. Just be aware of that. Interesting. This imaginary play of conditions. I was feeling weak, and I said, I better, you know, put on some more muscle and feel stronger. So I've been eating more. Very noticeably. I say, why am I doing this? Well, it's nervousness. So I can't complain about anything because the self-evidency is arising, which is the goal. You know, that's what we want. We want self-evidency to arise. The dawning of self-evidency. And that's imperceptible, right? Perception has to do with conditions, you know, believing that they're conditions. I'm perceiving and therefore evaluating conditions. But for the mind, there are no conditions. So how can it arise through in perception? It can't. It's self-evident. It's imperceptibly self-evident. It's imperceptibly self-evident. Peace of God is imperceptible. Imperceptible gentleness, which is self-evidency. We imagine it's something's resting upon the mind. So we're still imagining there's some condition upon the mind, but this condition we're imagining is this imperceptibly soft, gentle peace of God resting upon the mind. But we're capping our expectations right there, okay? Because beyond that, there's nothing at all that can be said, actually. So it's futile to tilt at that windmill here, as long as we're in this world. We cap our expectations with the peace of God, which feels as if there's some imperceptibly soft and gentle and lovely, beautiful condition resting upon everything, resting upon the mind that's just everywhere, smooth everywhere. Now that's the final illusion that frees us from all other illusions. So the key is to cap your expectations there. And of course, our fear of self-evidency defends the belief in conditions. And so it wants to avoid this peace of God because it knows once we get used to that, then truly we'll even put that down, set that gently aside at some point down the road. So what it does is it tries to get us to go beyond that, even though we're not ready for that at all, which terrifies us, which causes us to back away from even the peace of God. Okay? It's a real tricky situation. So anyone who's trying to push you or suggest that you should go beyond the peace of God, they're actually trying to get you to not accept the peace of God. They say, oh, peace of God, great, but now you need to go beyond it, you know. There's a step beyond that. Now they're racketeers, actually. There's plenty of spiritual racketeers in the world that will do this one-upsmanship, gamesmanship on you. But here, we intentionally, part of the being an apex yogin, you cap your expectations. It's a peace of God. Cap it. Jesus plainly says you need to cap it because if you went beyond, which you can, you could not really stay here, function here. So, and there's nothing at all that can be said or pointed to or anything like that. And so he says, don't make that your goal at all. That's not the goal of our curriculum here at all. At all. That's out. So those who are trying to bait you into that are racketeers because they don't want you to have the peace of God. They don't want you to have that because then they can't extort from you. If you have the peace of God, who can extort from you? How can you be extorted, actually? You say, I already have the one final illusion that I need, and I don't need any other. So they're worried about their, you know, spiritual racketeering. Spirituality is a racket. It's racketeering. They're worried about losing that. So again, we cap our expectations here. Peace of God. That's it. Which is imperceptibly gentle and soft. Since there's no conditions at all, the final imaginary condition to be helpful to us needs to have this quality of imperceptibility. But we feel that it's there. We feel, we don't see it, but we feel the peace of God. You don't see the peace of God, you feel it. We feel there's a super soft gentleness resting upon all perception, upon all what we imagine as conditions, resting upon everything. It seems to be the one condition of everything. It's the one final illusion. But we're not perceiving it. We're feeling it. We feel it. It's a feeling. And we say, well, it's an imperceptible condition. That's why we're not seeing it. It's imperceptible. It's so gentle. It's so gentle, it's imperceptible. The gentleness is so refined and gentle. It's even beyond our perception. This is what we call the peace of God. Jesus said, the peace that passeth understanding. All understanding. It passeth understanding. We cannot understand it. We cannot perceive it. We cannot evaluate it. It's so gentle and so soft, it's beyond evaluation. So we don't try to completely eliminate perception or evaluation. We just have one perception, one evaluation, which is that it's beyond. It's the perception that's imperceptible, and it's the evaluation that's beyond evaluation. So we still say it's there, it's just we can't see it. It's imperceptible, but we feel it. We feel it. I lived in dreams, but strange as it seems, love came to me. Right? Love came to me. I lived and dreamed, but strange as it seems, love came to me. So, we prepare for this peace of God. That's Apex Yoga. We prepare for this. We expect it, and we're getting more and more clear about it. So as this gunfight is taking place at the OK Corral between the townsmen, the new sheriff, and the racketeers, we ride off into a nice valley, peaceful valley, and camp out there for a while. And not worry about the gunfight, and let the dust settle on it. Let the dust settle on it. So like get on your horse and you know ride out of town, and you see the townsmen like, oh, the kind of the ones who are kind of meek and say, okay, let's get in our carriages and get in the horses, and we're gonna go off to, you know, a little place down a different area for a while and just, you know, let the gunfighters fight it out, which is what gunfighters do. But you can also tell how difficult it is for those who believe in conditions to understand anything at all about salvation, about the peace of God. It just, you know, it you can understand why they don't get it. For them, peace of God comes when the gunfighter, the new sheriff, you know, gets rid of all the racketeers, and they go back to town and say, oh, finally got peace in our town now. That's what they're looking for. We're not looking for that. We're looking for the genuine peace of God, which is really the final step in setting down the illusion of conditions, the mind accepting self-evidency, yet still wanting to appear here, appear and function and communicate and all that to help others out of compassion. We cap our expectations. Now, that doesn't mean that we won't go beyond even that. At some point, we will. But let God take that step. That's just a term, right? But let God take that step. We need not concern ourselves with that at all. We're concerned about the peace of God. So we keep coming back to this. This rosary is yucky. I mean, the way that it looks, it's really yucky. That's enough of that. It's... Blueberries. Living on blueberries. So we're not in a rush here. We just allow this to sink in. We don't try to force it to sink in. If you're in a rush, you'll try to force it to sink in. Big mistake. This creates dissociative type of mental setup. We let it sink in the way the ground lets water sink in, lets rain sink in, right? We're like the ground, and the rain falls on the ground. Is the ground forcing water to sink in? No, it allows it to sink in. It doesn't do anything, it just sinks in. Let's gravity work on it, so to speak. Just an analogy, but we just let this truth just sink in. That's why we have to be patient. Committed to non-action here. Be committed to non-action. Oh, I know what that extra taste is. Coconut. I put coconut in there. Green coconut. I don't really taste the flavor, though. I felt a little piece of coconut there. So, that's coconut. I do have some coconut cream I could put in there, but that's a lot of calories. It's amazing. I can gain 4 pounds in a couple days, easy. Law of perception is we see what we want to see. Perception doesn't show us something. We show perception something. Perception is not created. We are, what we desire to perceive is what we perceive. Perception isn't going out and telling us what it perceives and discovering stuff. No, that's not how it is at all. We perceive what we want to perceive. We want to perceive a world. A world arises. But we're not really perceiving it. We're just experiencing it, imagining it. Very traditional California seasons this year. We're getting so used to drought, and now this has gone back to a wet type of pattern. The allergies are horrible, apparently. People are suffering terribly from them. Everything is just, you know, there's just, everything is blooming everywhere. Putting off pollen like crazy. I'm not affected by allergies, hardly at all. Because I lived here my whole life, I guess I've built up, you know, immunity to them, but... Sometimes I feel tired, and I realize probably the immune system battling with all that pollen or something. There's a gunfight going on in the immune system. But again, all illusion. But still, we cater to it. But we're aiming for the peace of God, which doesn't cater to illusion. It's the final catering to it, you might say. It's the final catering. So all catering has been boiled down into just one final catering, what we call the peace of God. All evaluation boiled down to one evaluation, peace of God. The practicing, flattening, is the wow practice. But once we've done all that wow practice, the fruit of that is the peace of God. And those who want to go in that direction will be attracted to it. Apparently, a flock will be attracted to it at some point. I don't want to force it. It just will happen, apparently. That's what Jesus tells us. The sheep know the shepherd, so to speak. And the shepherd know the sheep. There's some sort of automatic gravitation that takes place, meaning like those birds come zooming in. Those who want to go this way will just automatically pick up on it. So we're going slowly here, but the shock. It's not like don't have success. No, we're having so much success, it's quite shocking. It's like if you get like a hole in one on a golf course, or an eagle, or an albatross, and you know, par five in two shots, or even better, a hole in one on a par four. You're in shock. You say, "I was so successful. Suddenly, I had this amazing success out there." And so the rest of the round, you might muddle around. It ruins your round, but that's okay. It's a round well ruined. Because you'll remember that albatross. Oh my gosh, I did that. I remember. We talk about our eagles. I remember my eagles. You know, this one and this one. But you don't remember every round of golf. Most people don't. But you remember that hole in one, you guys. Remember that hole in one, what hole it was, and everything. So it does. So if you muddle around a little bit after great success, that you're supposed to muddle around a little bit. So we expect our functioning we'll just be muddling around. Because we're in shock. We're like, oh my gosh. I can hit the ball in the hole directly. Wow. I didn't know I could do that, but I did it. Changes your expectations of yourself. I've never had a hole in one. Because I haven't wanted to. You know, I said, no. Oh, I'm still working on my round of golf, but hole in one will really shock you. I'd rather enjoy the round of golf than get a hole-in-one. But it's just the example. But if it happens, if I decide to, then it'll happen. And it's like, wow, really, really shocking. That's great. And it may take you like several days to calm down, or a day to calm down from it. The more you get, the easier it is to calm down. But at first, it's there are people who are like, once you get one, it seems like you get more. People I talk to, people say, oh yeah, somehow my dad had like, you know, 11 holes in one in his life. 11. You're like, what? There's some pro golfers that never had even one. In this case, this guy has 11. So once you start getting them, you know, you say, oh, okay, I can handle this. Change of expectations. Peace of God. Once we start experiencing it, we say, oh, I can handle this. It still seems like it's a condition, but I just can't perceive it. And I can't analyze it. Since I can't perceive it, I can't analyze it. It's beyond analysis. It's beyond perception. It's beyond measurement. And yet I feel it. It's plainly felt. It's so close to no condition that it's so near to setting down false belief, so close that it can't even be measured. The closeness can't even be measured. It cannot even be analyzed. It cannot be seen. It can only be felt. It can only be felt. Feeling, being our native condition, is more, vastly more precise and sensitive than any measurement or analysis could ever be. So the peace of God can only be felt. And so you're looking, like I was looking around at everything. I said, everything feels so soft and gentle, like there's some soft gentleness resting upon everything. But I couldn't see it perceptually, but I was feeling it. That's how it is, like that. So we're not in a hurry here to see something, to perceive something. That's why we sort of just rest like this, like it's accepting self-evidency of it. That there'll be nothing to analyze. There'll be nothing to measure. There'll be nothing to look at. Nothing to perceive. Nothing to evaluate at all in the peace of God. And yet we will feel it. So we're letting that whole aspect of our mind of analysis and measurement and evaluation, we're just letting that all settle down. We're not expecting anything from that. It doesn't play any role in the peace of God. On the right side of the boat, Jesus said, catch the right side of the boat. Right-mindedness, which is the quality of the mind of abstraction, we would say. In duality, in this falsity of duality, we speak in terms of right and left. The right side of the boat means abstraction. The capacity to handle abstraction, meaning there's something there, there's a condition there. It's an imaginary condition, but that we're going to accept that peace of God. But I can't see it. Cannot measure it, cannot analyze it, cannot define it, cannot evaluate it at all, but I feel it's there. You could say this is faith, but it is the final imaginary condition. Okay, and again, we're not trying to totally go beyond the belief in conditions while we're still functioning here in the world. That would be an absurd burden to place on us, and so we reject that. That's the notion of bodhisattva. They don't take the final step. They remain helping others out. This is just a way of expressing what we're talking about here. That's not to say that they haven't taken the final step, but the path of bodhisattva is to cap expectations. It's a wisdom to cap expectations. And those who are trying to go beyond that, they're not even going to get the peace of God. But their whole thing is, hey, well, I don't need the peace of God. I'm going beyond that. You know, no. That's don't trust in those who say that. They wouldn't even be functioning here if that was the case, if they had gone beyond it, really. And on to my ma, when she would go beyond it at times, and then she'd come back, says, well, I can't function here if I go beyond. Her body turns like to ice, and all breath, pulse, everything, the body just ceases working entirely. And when they finally revive her, she said, well, I went to the great beyond, the great bliss, beyond the beyond, meaning not even the peace of God, beyond that. But she says that when you do that, you cannot function here. That's what Jesus told us. And so she showed us that. So she said, that don't make that your goal. Don't make that your goal. Your goal is the peace of God. She showed that they cannot function here. The body could remain here in a frozen, suspended animation state, yeah, but it's not really moving around, functioning. Theoretically, it could be in a cave and body could remain that way indefinitely, actually. Because the body is, again, it's just the imagination of mind. It's not a condition, really. So don't get lured by those wolves in sheep's clothing who tell you that you can go even be better. You don't need a piece of God. You can be even more enlightened than that. Those are wolves in sheep's clothing. The good shepherd says, cap your expectations. To remain functional in this world, the peace of God is the highest that you can go. And that's all that's required, all that's necessary. The Dharma kings don't ask us to go any higher than that. Because we couldn't function here. We want to evangelize here. So, certainly, we don't want to just leave this realm at this point. We're already there, okay? So it's not a question of someone being greater than us. There's no conditions for the mind. So how can there be anyone's greater than us? That's talking about conditions. Anyone says they're greater than you, in ultimate sense, they're just trying to convince you there's such a thing as conditions. The mind cannot be conditioned. So how could there be said that there's greater mind or lesser mind? What could bring about lesser mind? It cannot be brought about. So just let this settle down. Many pursue the wolves in sheep's clothing so they can avoid the peace of God, so they can keep playing this play of conditions and thinking they can be greater than someone else. It's the only way you can think that you're better than anyone is to believe in conditions, right? So they seek it out. So we have to be careful of that we don't seek it out. Our goal is just the peace of God. The peace of God is our guru. Now the Dharma kings are examples that show us, but their goal for us is for us to experience the peace of God. We're to be the gurus of our own path, our own peace of God. So the self-evidency of that, it bears repeating over and over and over and over and over here. So we have to be patient. Those who are in a hurry for action want one explanation, and then they want to spring into action. Here, since we're committed to non-action, we can hear the same explanation from slightly different angles over and over and over and over and over and over and over again. Over and over again. This is what it takes. Because we're not trying to use an explanation to galvanize action. But that's really how it is, right? I mean, people say, can you explain that to me? Meaning, I'm ready to take action, but maybe, can you have some advice how I can take action more effectively? And then, but they're so ready to take action that you give them an explanation, and then boom, okay, I got it. That's it. They want like a 2-minute thing. Because they're here again, we spend hours just sitting here. This is what really works. We're not aiming for any action at all. We're aiming just for the peace of God. That's our goal. That's our only goal. No, have no other gods before you. Just this one condition. God in that way means a condition. Have no other conditions before you. Just one condition. Peace of God. Because really nothing at all can be said about reality. It's utterly redundant, really. All value everywhere, always. You can say that, I guess. All value everywhere, always. So therefore, to say anything specific about it, any evaluation of it, is ridiculously redundant from the beginning, you know? it's all value. So what are you talking about, one value? That's ridiculous. It's all value everywhere, always. So action, is being addicted to action is a terrible addiction. And all these video games, that this is creating a terrible addiction in the minds of everyone here. Hardly anyone can just sit still like this, committed to non-action. Hardly anyone. Problem with Facebook is, I noticed that everything is boom, 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 boom. Like, post. It's action. There's so much action on Facebook. It's a place of a tremendous amount of action. And everybody's posting news stories and reactions and all this stuff. There's reactions, evaluations. They're posting all this evaluating, massive amount of evaluating. And posts are like, be constantly in action, sorting through all this evaluation. So this is a terrible practice to do. It's horrible. It's ruinous. It doesn't matter if it's spiritual quotes. It's the habit of taking action, quickly taking action. That's ruinous. We have to get familiar with this, the peace of God. And so we need to hear it over and over and over and over and let it sink in, like rain sinking into the ground. And work on familiarity. If we're committed to action, will we leave that immediately? Okay, I got it, and I've got to go do something. Chase after values, you know, chase after that. And so, you better be careful about your habits. Facebook produces bad habits in you. This is what I noticed. I had to put the brakes on it. Basically, Jesus told me, Holy Spirit told me, grace of God told me, you got to put the brakes on this right now. And that was it. I got some pushes from some very shady characters that kind of scared me off and said, wow, you know, this is getting really scary. That's enough. But they were just helping me leave Facebook. They're really friends in the guise of shady characters. And then I slammed the brakes on, and then Jesus showed up in my dreams and said, let's go. We're going to go on this level path now. Instead of going plummeting downhill, we're going to go along the mountainside in a level path, beautiful, smooth, level path. He showed up instantly and said, okay, let's take a bike ride here. Let's take a nice, smooth, peaceful, calm bike ride, so to speak, instead of this mountain bike careening down the mountain. Which is really just, it's the grace of God showing up. So that was the result of slamming on the brakes, putting the brakes on that bad habit, those bad habits. And it's very addictive. The more you get into action, the more addictive it becomes. And the less tolerance you have for genuine, effective practice, which is the repetition over and over. It's a familiarity. Familiarity is decisive. That's why I spend so much time here in the videos, repeating over and over. That's real teaching. That's real witnessing. It's just this. Repetitive, repetitive. Let it sink in, let it sink. Don't take any action on anything you hear yet. You just let it sink in. Because really, we're going towards self-evidency, which transcends action. You just see it without any condition of action necessary to see it. And then you recognize the peace of God is the right step to take. You say, oh yeah, okay. Because I cannot, because of this massive collective effort and massive collective karma of habits, it's, I couldn't even stay here, you know, if I went, dropped all conditions. So let me just have one condition that frees me from all other conditions. It's self-evident that that is the correct step to take. But it's not a step that we're used to hearing at all. So it's difficult. I mean, to hear it over and over and over until it becomes very normal, very natural. You say, oh, of course that's it. And then the resistance, the familiarity bias is gradually attenuated in this way. People in lousy climates generally can have more success than those in a super nice temperate climate like the Bay Area. That environment breeds failure because it's easy to take action here. Everybody's just constantly on the go. Constantly on the go. They can't, you know, all they can handle is sound bites. That's it. That's the culture here. Sound bite culture. It's ruinous for your spiritual path. Whereas in real cold, lousy climates, foggy, you know, you just feel like sitting in by a fire and just sitting quietly. You don't feel like doing anything. This is very helpful. Very helpful. And in a hot climate also, you just feel like sitting by the fan or sitting by the cooler and just, let's just hang out by the cooler here and drink some cold drinks and we're good. And then you just see the good old boys around the cooler on a hot, muggy place, and they're just drinking their soft drinks or whatever, and they're telling stories over and over. They've heard the same story maybe 100 times, you know. Hey, let me tell you about that time I was at the racetrack, you know. And well, they're reinforcing familiarity by doing that instead of taking a bunch of new action. So hot desert is good, cold Himalaya cave is good, foggy gloomy moor is good, you know, peat bog or something. I mean, inimical climates are very good, where this delightful climate of the Bay Area is, it's ruinous for most. But there's such a thing as a climate being so nice that the saving grace of this, there is a way that it's helpful. It's so nice you don't even feel like doing anything. You just feel like it's perfect just the way it is. I don't need to do anything. Everything's already perfect. So that's what I do. I just say, oh, the day is so nice. Why ruin it by doing anything? It's perfect. Let me just drink in this perfection of it and just sit here and don't do anything. So there's that angle you can take. That's the angle I've taken, but most have not taken that here. You can always ruin any situation, but The go, go, go atmosphere here is just amazing. People are always rushing somewhere. Always rushing somewhere. No one has a time to smile, say hello, stop the action, evaluate, and to consider maybe everything's perfect just right now. I'm just not seeing it. Maybe I can feel perfection everywhere. The one condition of perfection everywhere, resting. But I still feel it's conditioned, but it's resting. So there's no way I can analyze how I could lose it. You see, peace of God is set. You can't analyze it at all. Therefore, there's no way to analyze how it's possible to even lose this. Well, that's important to look at it. I hadn't looked at it that way before, so this is a really helpful. You see, as we're just patient like this, something really important comes up. That if we spring into action, that never would have arisen. It is a Saturday morning, and it's, what is it, 12, just turned 12 o'clock, and this, what better use of your time than this? No better use of time. It's imaginary time, but of course, but for the sake, because we're aiming for one last condition, we can talk in non-dual terms, like time and stuff. We can use those terms. We're not, you know, term Nazis, right? I mean, word Nazis. We're careful about it, but we understand we're not aiming to be liberated from all conditions. We're aiming to have one final condition, which then our interest in conditions will vanish entirely from that one last condition, and then ultimately that gets set down as well. Ultimately. So I forgot what I just said because the shock of it was so strong. Oh, okay. Yeah, it's so important. I need to kind of recall that. So important that it's so imperceptible. There's no way we don't have any idea how we can not have this peace of God, how we can get rid of it. So we have to accept that too, that it seems very permanent for us. Everything else we can find a way to get rid of, right? It seems like all other conditions, but this condition we can't, since we can't understand how it came upon us anyway, can't perceive it at all, can't analyze it, can't evaluate it, can't measure it in any way. How can we figure out how to get rid of it? Doesn't seem to have any metrics at all to deal with to mess it up. Like, it's like we can't mess it up. There's no way to mess it up. So this is sort of a meta recognition. This may be what causes us to be so startled. So it feels very much like this is it. We've stumbled across this because of our dedication here to just sitting quietly. The peace of God arrives, and imperceptibly you say, "Wow, I don't even know how it arrived," and you think this is wonderful. And then at some point we say, "Yeah, but I don't even know how to get rid of this." And then we get frightened. And then that fear, then we spring into some sort of mental action, and then it seems to depart, but we still don't know how it departed either. So we don't know how it departs, we don't know how it arises. It's imperceptible. So that sort of panics us when we say, it dawns on us, I don't know how to get rid of this. What if I wanted to get rid of it? Well, Jesus tells us that God takes the final step, so we don't need to worry about that. Now, this is a way of speaking to this issue. But if people say, well, what if I want to get rid of it? Well, why do we want to get rid of it? This is our goal. We don't want to get rid of our goal. We've reached our goal. We want to now remain. That's our goal, is the peace of God be upon us all the rest of our days. So it's a good thing we don't know how to get rid of it. We can't perceive, there's no way to evaluate or figure out how to do that. So this is quite shocking. But it's great we got to this, now we can be shocked by it. And let that settle in. We got a nice thunderstorm, and now let the rain settle in. French rolls with butter and peanut butter. I knew I was going to gain weight, but I didn't know it'd be that much. It's always more than I expect. so I have to. But yeah, we talk about nothing at all here, just to keep sitting quietly in non-action. Don't try to take any action to get rid of the peace of God, because then we go into panic. And then panic makes it seem that it's gone. We just imagine that we figured out some way. We perceiving it. And at that point, we're now back into evaluations and multiple conditions. So we have abandoned it. But you can abandon it, but you can never figure out how to get free of it. But abandoning it is possible. Just as we can accept it, we can also reject it. But there's no way to get rid of it. Because we can't perceive it, can't analyze it, can't measure it. There's no metrics at all to work on. So we just end up abandoning it. That's why the dream I had of this infant, which was really the peace of God in a dream long ago, 40 years ago, was abandoned. Completely abandoned. And nobody paid any heed to it. I just ignored it completely. I couldn't get any information from anyone. I said, this is what? This is crazy. Well, it is total abandonment. So the only way to get rid of not experience the peace of God is total abandonment of it. And holding that with panic, which turns into action, constantly, I'm active, I'm doing this, I'm thinking this, I'm doing this, reacting, all this stuff. Yeah. I didn't know what the infant was. I said, well, but I said, I cannot just let this go. I got to take care of this infant until I find who it belongs to. Well, it turns out to be the peace of God itself. It was the divine child itself, which represents the peace of God. So nobody cleverly thinks their way free of the peace of God. They only abandon it. So this needs to be brought to light. How do we lose it? We abandon it. Absolutely abandon it. Totally turned away from it. And how do we accept it? We totally turn back to it. We accept self-evidency. But in doing so, of course, the only way to be free of the peace of God is total abandonment of it. Which is a lot of work to maintain that, right? That's the world culture right now, is a total abandonment of the peace of God. Total abandonment. We cannot partially turn away from it, because there's no metrics to do that on. So the mind, there's nothing there for the mind, no way for the mind to see such a possibility. It's imperceptibly gentle and soft. Immeasurably so. Beyond evaluation, beyond understanding. So there's no concept we have to turn away from. We just have to abandon it across the board totally. Just completely turn away from it. Just like that. And just like that, it seems to be gone. There's no half measure we can take to gradually leave it, really. Because it's so close to reality, there's no gradualness, there's no more gradualness present at all. There's no sense of gradualness present at all anymore. It's everywhere. It's smoothly everywhere, the peace of God. Smoothly everywhere. Thank you. not easy to go through the alternation of your in the weather of warm, real warm, and now real cool. And that's how we've been doing, alternating. All winter long, we've been alternating like this. Every 4 days, another storm comes. And after this one, we have another one, another 4 days. Next Thursday, another storm's supposed to come in. Pretty good rain there, too. And the temperatures will dip back down. It's like, wow, it's a roller coaster. So I haven't put away my winter clothes yet, no. It's not time. Before the storm came, it was 80s. 83, 84, I think, 82, then 78. Really balmy, like this, like Hawaii, beautifully balmy. And now it's shivery, cold. So I'm still layering. I've got 3 layers on right now, 4 with a shawl. Just stick with the layering for now. Desert, different story. Although I bet you it's cool down there right now too. Yeah. This has really cooled things off. I don't know what it's going to do to the wildflowers, all this rain. Maybe ruin them. Maybe give another jolt to them. I don't know. They're already all up, so that, you know, I don't know what the effect will be of this weather pattern. I do know I'm feeling very tired now, because the shock of this, seeing this, that our fear is that we can't find any way to leave it, that's really shocked me. Because now we have something to practice on, don't we? Which is vitally important. And so I recognize that it's hit me real hard, which is showing up as fatigue, drowsiness. Now, the more familiar we get with this, the less that reaction will occur. Ultimately, when we accept the peace of God, I expect my energy to go through the roof and I just won't get tired. Because no more shock to make you feel tired. Which will be great, because I spent my whole life being exhausted. Which is, you know, terrible. But I feel like, wow, like a sleeping drug has been given me. Oh. Now that's the effect. You can catch that. You feel that. You say, oh, for sure. That's what happened. Because I just had a good night's rest and it's only 12 o'clock. I should be feeling fine. But no, I am feeling... I can hardly keep my eyes open. And my nervous system feels like in shock. That's why. It tends to shut down. When you're in shock, you tend to shut down and go into a fetal position. Like, I want to just sleep. And the shock was seeing that just as you cannot see how it arrived, you cannot see how it's being sustained, nor can you see how it's possible to get rid of it. It's like the one condition that's not subject to any other conditions. Peace of God, wow. But of course that means that if you don't want to abandon it, then it will stay with you. You won't lose it at all. And you won't need, other than abandoning it, there's no way that you cannot experience it. That's a very secure feeling, isn't it? Why don't you see it that way? This is just like the worst day for golf ever. This is horrible. Wet, chilly, breezy, cold, breezy. That's misery. Absolute misery. You gotta get all bulked up with layers. You can't swing. You can't move well. And just everything becomes... Well, it's a good excuse for a drink, you know, right? Instead of playing golf, they'll probably get drunk or something. I don't know. Hey. Cat. Always moving about very stealthily and quietly. Listening, always listening. Is there something I need to pay attention to? Ears are moving around, quietly moving around its territory. Listening, listening, listening. And it knows what sounds to tune into, what sounds not to. So for me, if I talk to it, it won't pay any attention to me at all. It's already conditioned to tune that out. It's listening for any animal distress signals that might mean some easy pickings for it. It's really a huntress, that cat. The cats, they lie there quietly in their territory, but they're listening acutely. They're smelling, listening. Slightest little thing indicating, boom, and instantly. Like that. That's how they're, some of them are geared, right? The ones that have all the food they could want, some of them just lie around all day and say, I'm happy. I don't need to be on the prowl. Peace of God, you're happy, you don't need to be on the prowl for any other conditions. Because the mind, of course, wants to realize that it's native feeling, which is that it can never create conditions for itself. And that's true right now. So naturally, the peace of God is something that we just enjoy feeling all the time. It's not like at that point, we're not prowling for other conditions. We're not seeking for other conditions. We have the contentment. We're content just as we are. A consumeristic society will never teach this. This is why it's so difficult to teach this in today's culture and world, in the Bay Area. But if it can be taught in the Bay Area, in this culture, in this world, right now, it can be taught anywhere, really. we can turn our attention to it, really, is what we're doing. Of course, it doesn't seem many are turning their attention to it, but I am in this scene. So it can be done anywhere. So super breakthrough here, and we're just ushering it in. This is the work of just ushering in this breakthrough. Great breakthrough here. There's no way to get rid of it except total abandonment. That's it. So let us start focusing on this. When we're comfortable that there's no way to get rid of it except total abandonment, then it will certainly dawn upon us. So we're really working here with leverage at this point. Wow. total abandonment, wow. Peace of God, wow. Flat an evaluation of that. So what we do is we totally abandon it, and then we imagine conditions for the abandonment. It's not, see, that's but we're back in dreaming of conditions right away. But we're not honest about it. We're not honest that we totally abandon it. We very quickly dream a dream of how we left it, which is not a lie. It's not true. We totally abandon it. Just like if you want to imagine the bottle cap. If I wanted the bottle cap to not be there, it would just not be there. So that's total abandonment of the idea of the bottle cap being there. There's no conditions of gradual abandonment in mind. Mind doesn't work gradually. It's always direct, instantaneous and direct. When mind decides to drop the piece of God, that's instantaneous and direct. But then, it, not being honest, it makes up this dream, made up scenario of how it walked away from the peace of God. It didn't walk away. It abandoned it right on the spot. It makes up all these conditions. I took this step, and gradually I was able to abandon it. Now I might turn into a memory and have the memory fade away gradually, but the step of turning into a memory happens instantaneously. It's abandonment. So you're in the peace of God, and then suddenly you feel like, it's starting to fade away, you know, a little bit slowly. Well, actually, that's not fading away. You abandon it entirely, and then you make a memory of it, and then imagine other memories of it. Fainter memories, and so it seems like it's fading away, but no, it is not. It's not fading away. You're just sequencing different conditions, memory conditions, making them up, imagining them, to make it seem like it's fading away, but it actually, we set it down all at once, set the whole thing down, and we experience that. What we experience, we're in the groove, and then we experience we're fading out of the groove, but we say, what happened? I'm You know, what happened was we jumped out of the groove entirely, and then had a memory, denied that, and then had this memory of fading out of the groove. But that never happened. We jumped out of the groove. We abandoned it. So this is just tremendous. You know, getting to this morning is better than playing any round of golf, right? It really is. Get to this first, and then play golf. This is really great stuff we're getting to here. So we can say, I abandoned it. Wow. I didn't abandon it. Wow. I have it. Wow. I abandoned it. Wow. I had it. I have it. Wow. I abandoned it. Wow. So practice honesty and flattening out the evaluation of this. I have the peace of God, wow. I abandon the peace of God, wow. I have the peace of God, wow. I abandon the peace of God, wow. Very intense practice. I can feel it hitting me in an area I've never let the light come into before. You know, this is, it's like thawing out an area that was still frozen. Wow. And when you thaw out, it's kind of a little painful. I mean, it sort of has a sort of a stress quotient to it. It feels a little stressful. The burn of thawing out. You frozen fingers, you let it thaw out. It kind of burns, doesn't it? It's painful. It's easier just keep it frozen. You don't feel anything. But then you have to cut the finger off at some point. It's not good. So you got to go through the pain of this thaw out, the suffering of it. I have the peace of God, wow. I abandon the peace of God, wow. I have the peace of God now, wow. I abandon the peace of God now, wow. I have the peace of God, wow. I abandon the peace of God, wow. I have the peace of God, wow. I've abandoned the peace of God, wow. I have the peace of God, wow. I've abandoned the peace of God, wow. Try to keep the eyes open. Otherwise, you'll go into sleep. You'll fall into sleep. It's important. We like to practice with our eyes open, because the shock of success, like, will easily put us asleep. If we close our eyes, I could easily just drop off right now. So it's very important to keep the eyes open. Actually, open-eyed practice. Maybe my eating was a way to keep myself awake. But having these smoothies, I can keep sipping on, and that sort of engages. You know, it's hard to eat when you're asleep. I even, you know, French fries. I eat all these French fries. I said, wow, that's really going to put on weight. But I felt like it. Except I didn't have any salt on them. Or ketchup. Bummer. I like salt. And, you know, with a smoothie diet, I don't get much salt, so I like salty stuff. Keep in mind, if you're just drinking blueberries like this, and coconut and chocolate protein powder, there's no salt in that. And we need salt. Most people say they eat too much salty food, but you have to have some salt. So a lot of times I crave salt. And like, I'll eat a bunch of pretzels. I'll gain weight from eating salt potato chips. I'll eat potato chips, pretzels, whatever's got salt in it. It's probably better just to... what I should do is I should get some peanut butter and just put a bunch of salt on it. And that would take care of the salt thing without eating a bunch of pretzels. I have to be smarter about that. How do you get the salt intake? What's good to add salt to? Peanut butter, maybe? Probably. Yeah. So I'm going to do that. I'm just going to sprinkle a whole bunch of salt. I have salad at night and I put a lot of salt on it. That takes care of it. I've been eating these healthy salads. It's funny, you sat down with a bunch of guys yesterday, real blue-collar, hard-working guys. You think like steak guys. And they're all like new age eaters. You know, they all have their quinoa, their kale salads, and their butternut squash, and their cranberries, and their... And I said, oh, this is delicious. Yeah, I like the dressing on this. And I'm like, what? I think they're all... I didn't see any meat anywhere. They have, you know, all these different greens, cabbage, shredded Brussels sprouts, kale. You know, just, and that was their lunch. They're working really hard, and that's their lunch. I was like, wow, this is amazing. You never would have seen that. It's like, I was so shocked by it. I didn't know what their eating habits were. And no meat at all. Just these big salads, lots of really, you know, Trader Joe or Safeway. They have all these super healthy salads now. Veggie salads, all veggie. No, not even any chicken. I didn't see any chicken, nothing. Just veggie, veggie, veggie. Well, that's what I'm eating now. I go to Trader Joe's or whatever, wherever. You just get these prepackaged salads. They're very, very good. I don't, all this healthy stuff in them. Supposedly healthy. I don't know. Can you eat too much kale? I don't know. Possible, right? Well, so far I haven't haven't been bothered. Kale seems to go down nicely. It's good. I got a bunch of kale. What am I going to do with it? Juice it, I guess. Yeah. A bunch of kale smoothies coming up for me. Wow. How do I camouflage that again? Okay, yeah. I forgot, but there's ways to camouflage. Oh, banana. Banana helps a lot, yeah. I gotta freeze some bananas. If you freeze bananas, make sure you take the peel off first, because once the banana is frozen, you can't get the peel off at all. I forgot again, and I froze two bananas with a peel on them. They're useless. So I'm gonna peel some bananas, and so you put frozen bananas in. Maybe that'll, then a bunch of kale. That's pretty thick right there, huh? Then some cherry juice or coconut water or something, yeah. So I'll be drinking kale smoothies for the next week, probably. It's fun. It's torture. It's not really torture, but you know, it's like, it's a good habit to have. It's a placebo, right? You think you're doing something good for yourself. You feel like, I feel great. You know, I feel good. I'm eating great. I'm eating healthy. I feel good. And it sort of helps with the shock. Like I'm doing something physically to help with this shock of this practice we're doing, because this really, you know, it was very shocking. But you don't want to spring into action. You want to stay in inaction without going into sleep. That's why the Zendos, they have those with the bamboo stick walking around. See if any of the meditators are slipping into being asleep. Whack! Ah, I fell asleep. Yeah, it's easy because the shock of the practice. But really, I don't know how many of us really can handle that sort of intense practicing. I feel it's remember that most practices came out from the warrior class, the samurais, the warrior class, to help with their battle and their centeredness and the chaos and battle that's reigning around them, how they can stay calm, empty mind in battle. And the warrior class is all about action. They take on a challenge. They say, okay, we need to do this. Okay, we're going to sit, you know, quietly like this for like 8 hours a day and not move. It's like a physical challenge to them. But that is not the wisest path to take, really, like that. So a lot of people have tried that are not so much the warrior class. And how many in the warrior class does that succeed with, really? Very few. Very few. They see it as a challenge. Like here's a challenge. So they don't go at it in a gentle way. Here we go at it in a very gentle way, which I feel is certain to succeed. But the idea of just sitting without moving, Bodhidharma style, you know, facing a screen and Zen, you know, on a pillow facing a screen, oftentimes just a blank screen. And you're supposed to sit there in meditation for 8 hours, 10 hours. You know, long time, and you get drowsy. Whack! Oh, it's fine. Wakes you up, but that's just pushing things really strongly. It's a warrior approach. We don't really take a warrior approach here. It's close to it, right? It's close, but it's more gentle. We back off. We stay. Keep our eyes open. We can move our head around. Very faith-based approach. We know this is working. Full stop in the wow approach. Wow approach. So is it the same approach? Basic. Yeah, it's the same basic approach. But it's not a full-on warrior approach. Not a samurai approach. The martial arts again, or all that stuff is. It's very much the lifestyle, of course. It was a warrior lifestyle in the past in this world. Most of the guys were warriors. A lot of the women were warriors too. They had the warrior spirit, that's for sure. very much action oriented. Attack or be attacked, defend properly or be defeated, you know, stay full of action. Of course, all the warring is just an excuse for action. But and then there's a different style of those who are not in areas that had a lot of warring, but very few areas were like that, where they may be just much, much gentler type of approach. Patient approach. Not trying to force some result. Bodhidharma is staring at a wall. You know, that's a warrior approach for 10 years without, you know, just without, never being riveted. That's really trying to force it. But warrior classes, they like that force. They want to apply force to everything. So they apply force to their spiritual practice. It's not advisable. That's why they have, you know, master so-and-so and the lady, but, you know, this man, rarely does that work. Rarely does it work. But with this approach, this approach will work for everyone. If you're just willing not to try to force it. It's a patient, gentle approach. Which is helped by living here in the Silicon Valley area. You know, there's no war or conflict going on here. It's just utterly boring suburban life. I mean, it's so boring. You can't imagine. Nothing ever happens here. I've been here my whole life, basically. And just, you know, just birds chirping and occasional car goes up and down the street. That's it. Chimes, makes you feel something's happening. I have done it, just sit here in the house and never done anything. There's nothing coming along that sweeps you along. There's not bands in the street. There's not street action at all. Nothing's happening in the street. It's empty. Streets are empty here. Occasional bicyclist, jogger, but it's very empty. It's like the most boring place in the world, basically. But that enables this approach. I'm not missing anything. There's no nightlife. Very boring place, which is great. You know, very little crime in this area. So it's just you don't feel embattled. We do with the drivers now, but in general, no sense of combat or conflict going on. Everybody just goes to work, tries to make as much money as they can, and buy nice things, nice homes, and retire. That's what they're aiming for. So the warrior attitude isn't present here. So we don't say, I'm going on a 3-year retreat and I'm going to be staring at a wall and practicing 8 hours a day and saying all this and this and this. That's the warrior approach. That tends to have diminishing returns. Whereas for me now, the returns are getting better and better and better and better as I refuse to force anything. I refuse to force anything. Don't force it at all. Just be patient. Be committed to non-action. Just committed to non-action. Including not trying to force any results of non-action. Don't try to force the non-action. Have non-action towards non-action also. Don't try to force anything. Just be patient. Don't fall asleep. So this attitude is allowing these tremendous insights, tremendous clarification to arise. Now, if you have a warrior class of people, they can't do it this way. So you would have to give them a certain style that they feel that they're in combat with something. They're in combat with the ego, the mind. We're not in combat with anything here. But the warrior class, which is most throughout history, most of those who have taken the path have been warriors. And so that's why the history of religion seems to have this, you got to slay the ego, kill the ego, destroy the ego. Not true, not true at all. That's just their desire to be combative, to be in combat with something and then to defeat something. In order to defeat something, you have to have conditions. You have to believe in conditions. And that you believe that you're a condition that defeats some other condition. So right there from the get-go, it's rooted in failure, that sort of path, rooted in failure. We're not trying to overcome anything. We're just accept our familiarity bias, right? That's it. So we only need one remedy for that, peace of God. We're just letting go of our false belief in conditions, so we'll use one final condition to enable us that to ultimately happen. And again, it arrives imperceptibly, it leaves imperceptibly. It arrives all at once, it leaves all at once. It arrives because we accept it, it leaves because we abandon it. We've abandoned it. It doesn't abandon us, we abandon it. We don't leave it, we abandon it. And it doesn't arrive. What word would you use? It just simply appears. So the peace of God just appears imperceptible. How it arrives is imperceptible, and how it leaves is imperceptible because we abandon it. We can't see how we left it because we didn't leave it. We abandon it, and we can't see how it arrived because it didn't arrive. We just dropped our resistance to it. It's here. It's just here. I've always kept my eyes open during contemplation. As soon as I put my eyes closed, I start going off in thoughts and daydreaming and all this kind of stuff. Keeping them open prevents that. Some who are action, if they have their eyes open, they're compelled to act somehow. But not me. I don't really focus on anything in particular. My eyes are open. I'm not interested. So, but those who are warriors, they tend to work on it. They keep their eyes closed. But of course, then they see all sorts of things to combat with their eyes closed. And their mind conjures up all sorts of stuff, right? Yeah. It was better to just be in a familiar place where everything's familiar to you and keep your eyes open. And then you say, oh, there's really nothing to do with this or that. Then to close your eyes and dream about a whole bunch of different conditions that you're not used to, which then cause you to feel like you're in, you know, combat with them. It's better, I feel. With your eyes open, you can stay with the familiar, what you're familiar. So, that tree right there, okay, I've seen it a million times, and so it's still there. And nothing to do about it. Don't need to do anything about it. Close the eyes and all sorts of new, exciting, different conditions suddenly start arising in our imagining. And before you know it, we're lost in trying to combat those conditions. Also, Bodhidharma keeping his eyes open at a wall was the extreme of this, but it's going to extreme, which is a very combative sort of attitude. It's highlighting the principle, but we need to be able to continue on with the principle. Not many are going to sit staring at a wall for 10 years. That's extremely rare. And so that cannot be the guide for what we do in terms of pragmatic terms, but it illustrates the principle very well, is that, oh, there's just this wall here, and there's nothing I need to do with the wall, a familiar wall, and so there's no call for to combat anything or take action, and refusing to close his eyes and go into daydreaming, sleeping, kind of. Yeah, that's a good way to illustrate the principle. But we're not really called to do that. Meditating in the same place, the wow practice, in the same place every time, is very helpful. You get used to just your surroundings, so the eyes can be open, but your attention is not really being attracted to doing anything at all with what you're seeing. If you're always going to a different place, that's more difficult. Makes it more difficult. That's for sure. I have found that it's, being in the same place is very helpful. Fatigue's coming on upon me again. That means the very, very, very powerful recognition. The peace of God is with me. Wow. I've abandoned the peace of God. Wow. I've accepted the peace of God. Wow. I've abandoned the peace of God. Wow. I've accepted the peace of God. Wow. I've abandoned the peace of God. Wow. I've accepted the peace of God. Wow. I've abandoned the peace of God. Wow. Those are the only two parameters in play. Either we accept it or we abandon it. I've accepted the peace of God. Wow. I've abandoned the peace of God. Wow. So there's all these dark corners, so to speak, of the mind that we're trying to keep hidden. We don't want to be aware of it. And so seeking these out and finding them is vitally important. And this is certainly one of those. It's new territory for me to look at. I've accepted the peace of God. Wow. I've abandoned the peace of God. Wow. I've accepted the peace of God. Wow. I've abandoned the peace of God. Wow. I've accepted the peace of God. Wow. I've abandoned the peace of God. Wow. I've accepted the peace of God. Wow. I've abandoned the peace of God. Wow. I've accepted the peace of God. Wow. I've abandoned the peace of God. Wow. I've accepted the peace of God. Wow. I've abandoned the peace of God. Wow. So meditative advice may differ depending on what your karma is, you know, how much you orient towards action and combat and various different ways. So different advice is given out, but that's superficial. I mean, the goal is the same as the peace of God. And peace of God can either be accepted or abandoned. That's it. That's the same for everyone. Yeah, I've been eating too much. Big salads with spaghetti and cheese on them. For sure. I've been doing that for like 4 days now. So that's why I gained the weight. I'll take it off again. Spaghetti will really do it, won't it? Big salads too, but it's bulk. It traps fluid, you know, fiber and bulk. It's heavy. Those big salads are heavy. Sometimes if you mix everything up in a salad, you lift it, it's a lot of weight to it. And that fiber stays in you a long time, not like this smoothie, just being liquid, doesn't stay in you so long. I've accepted the peace of God. Wow. I've abandoned the peace of God. Wow. I've accepted the peace of God. Wow. I've abandoned the peace of God. Wow. I've accepted the peace of God. Wow. I've abandoned the peace of God. Wow. I've accepted the peace of God. Wow. I've abandoned the peace of God. Wow. I've accepted the peace of God. Wow. I've abandoned the peace of God. Wow. I've accepted the peace of God. Wow. I've abandoned the peace of God. Wow. I've accepted the peace of God. Wow. I've abandoned the peace of God. Wow. Brings immediate sleepiness. I almost fell asleep just saying that. It's like, so, again, this is what you want to get to in your practicing. You want to dig deeper and deeper in, and you will feel this, that you really came upon something here. And now you feel, oh, you're getting drowsy. The allure of forgetfulness, abandon it to sleep, right? There's an abandonment right there. The warrior class, yeah, they do go after practice, like, yeah, we're really going to smashing victory here, you know. Start out real strong, but then later, they abandon it. They abandon it. See them later, it's like, nothing ever happened. I mean, where's the continuity? Yeah. So it's better to go into it easy, stay with it easy, come out of it easy, gently. The gentle approach is better, really. It's more effective. Less erratic. The warrior thing is very erratic. Battles. But, I mean, it theoretically it could work. It can work. Occasionally it does. But we're more gentle. We just look at it, wow it, let it sink in. More of a Taoist sort of approach of just... Just let everything, just let it be. A Taoist approach. The Tao of Wow, actually, is what we do. But my nerves, my mind is just really reverberating right now. The breakthroughs I've had continuously seems like, but from coming from last night, every day it's like this. But last night though, this is just, you know, really so to the point, right? That I feel shaken up. Keep the eyes open. Oh, my mind is drifting off there, trying to drift off. Memories of the past, of a memory arose that I've forgotten for a long time, forgot. Just let it go. I've accepted the peace of God. I've abandoned the peace of God. Wow. I've accepted the peace of God. Wow. I've abandoned the peace of God. Wow. I've accepted the peace of God. Wow. I've abandoned the peace of God. Wow. I can feel this is super central to success. Super central to success. This awareness. So practice like this. I've accepted the peace of God. Wow. Now I've abandoned the peace of God. Wow. Don't allow for any other evaluation. Just those two. I've accepted the peace of God. Wow. I've abandoned the peace of God. Wow. So all practicing can really boil down to just that, can't it? I've accepted the peace of God. Wow. I've abandoned the peace of God. Wow. If I had a hammer, I'd hammer in the morning. I'd hammer in the evening, all over this land. If I had a practice. Yeah. Of course, that's a socialist song. I'd hammer out justice. I'd hammer out peace. I'd hammer out freedom, all over this land. It's a socialist song, if I had a hammer. Folk songs are generally socialists. Propaganda, actually. Hammer is a symbol of the, you know, sickle and hammer of socialism. But we can use that song, I had a hammer, if I had a hammer. If I had a practice, if I had a practice, I'd practice in the morning. I'd practice in the evening, all over this land. I'd practice out accepting. I'd practice out abandoning. I'd practice out wowing all over this land. I'd hammer out practicing. If I had a practice, I'd practice in the morning, right? Well, that's what I do. I practice in the morning, I practice in the evening, I practice all day. I've accepted the peace of God. Wow. I've abandoned the peace of God. Wow. Those are the only two parameters in play. We've narrowed it down to those two parameters and are practicing down to those two parameters. That's how fortunate we are, how blessed we are right here. Now, if it's a nice day, I might be saying, let me wander around and do something, but this day is not nice, so I figure there's nothing to do but this, just focus on this. I've accepted the peace of God. Wow. I've abandoned the peace of God. Wow. I've accepted the peace of God. Wow. I've abandoned the peace of God. Wow. Eyes open. I've accepted the peace of God. Wow. I've abandoned the peace of God. Wow. I've accepted the peace of God. Wow. I've abandoned the peace of God. Wow. I've accepted the peace of God. Wow. I've abandoned the peace of God. Wow. warrior mentality charges into stuff, then it charges out of stuff. But here, we've just accepted the peace of God. Wow, we've abandoned the peace of God. There's no charging out of it. There's no charging into it, and there's no retreating out of it. So the whole warrior thing is gone with the peace of God. It's transcended. It's not applicable. I've accepted the peace of God. Wow. I've abandoned the peace of God. Wow. There's no charging into it, and there's no retreating out of it. Abandoned the peace of God. I've accepted the peace of God. Wow. I've abandoned the peace of God. Wow. I've accepted the peace of God. Wow. I've abandoned the peace of God. Wow. I've accepted the peace of God. Wow. I've abandoned the peace of God. Wow. I've accepted the peace of God. Wow. I've abandoned the peace of God. Wow. I've accepted the peace of God. Wow. I've abandoned the peace of God. Wow. Now, we're in a hurry. You make no mistake about it, but we're making haste slowly here. I mean, because the gunfight, you know, the sheriff, the new sheriff and the racketeers are starting to, you know, bullets are starting to fly. You gotta duck, take cover when that happens. Take cover in a hurry. You know, all the townspeople are scurrying, you know, up on their porches and slamming their doors, bolting the doors, getting under, closing the curtains, you know. The gunfight is about to happen. The corrupt sheriff, the old corrupt, the corrupt mayor is opening up their safe and the safe town safe and frantically getting all the money out because they're ready to flee. You know, all this stuff's going on, right? We know kind of how it's going to end, but not the exact details. So we watch it. You're like, huh, I wonder, you know, how's that corrupt mayor? What's going to happen to that? It's, and sometimes, you know, they repent, right, and join forces. Other times, they meet a bad end. And sometimes this very nice woman of the town, the town queen bee, turns out to be the lover of the chief of the racketeers. You know, you find that out, and it's like, oh my gosh, I thought she was nice. I thought she was nice, but she's been living in luxury, off the mistress of the chief of the boss of the racketeers. Oh my gosh. You see, so you're not sure who's who in the town, right, in the Western. That's that they introduced all these characters, and you're saying, huh, you know, how are they, how's it, what are they really like? And they give certain foreshadowings that you can pick up on. But sometimes, you know, it turns to get a twist at the end. You find, wow. Follow the money, and people who were so pious and righteous turned out to be in league with the racketeers. They're getting payoffs. And the mistress of the racketeer, once the racketeers are defeated, then she goes to the new sheriff and says, "Hi, sheriff." You know, and we say, "Uh-oh, he's gonna fall for her." But the new sheriff says, "You know, we don't want your kind around here. Get in that carriage. Here's some money. Go to the next town." You're not. And then she leaves in humiliation, kind of like she has to go to the next town. But she tries. She tries, right, to cozy up to the new sheriff. "Hey, sheriff. Wow, you're really great. You rid of the town of that terrible racketeer, and Man, I mean, I really like you. You're my type. He says, "Well, yeah, thanks, but you're not my type. So, here's a ticket out of town. Consider yourself fortunate." She's like, "Oh." It's a morality play. Westerns are a morality play, aren't they? Certainly they are. A great art form, actually, westerns. You don't want to make the morality play too foggy. You know, all the newer stuff is like the bad guys are really the good guys, and the good guys are really the bad guys, and it's all foggy, and nobody can really tell, and we're all stupid. I mean, it tears down the morality of a nation. All the newer stuff, but just those clear morality plays. I enjoyed watching some of those Westerns. I'd w watch a few of them. They say, "Well, you know, this is a good, strong morality play here. It's a real a helpful cultural for culture and society and civilization, that type of morality play." Of course, the Greeks used it. It's been used throughout history, morality plays. You don't want to make them too esoteric and vague and nihilistic and atheistic and all this kind of stuff. Dead people lose their inner compass, right? They do. So I've accepted the peace of God. Wow. I've abandoned the peace of God. Wow. I've accepted the peace of God. Wow. I've abandoned the peace of God. Wow. I've accepted the peace of God. Wow. I've abandoned the peace of God. Wow. I've accepted the peace of God. Wow. I've abandoned the peace of God. Wow. I've accepted the peace of God. Wow. I've abandoned the peace of God. Wow. I've accepted the peace of God. Wow. I've abandoned the peace of God. Wow. I've accepted the peace of God. Wow. I've abandoned the peace of God. Wow. I've accepted the peace of God. Wow. I've abandoned the peace of God. Wow. So we don't want to be like warriors saying this continuously for 5 hours. That's overload. So you see, we gently go into it, gently go out of it, back off of it. We don't charge into it. So we sort of gently just sort of segue into it, then gently come out of it. Give ourselves some, to breathe a little bit and get used to it. This is how familiarity happens. If you do it 5 hours straight, this intense practice, the backlash will be enormous, and you may not practice again for weeks. That's the way to go about it. Don't be a spiritual warrior. Be a spiritual wise one. Be full of spiritual wisdom, not full of spiritual whoredom. Be skillful in the practicing, how you go into it and how you come out of that practicing. Have a long session, but within that long session, many little practices like we're doing. Okay, many little practices like that. That's the way to do it. That's the right way to do it. Don't try to bust down the doors. So be gentle, and just like shutting a car door, just nice and don't like slam the car door as hard as you can. You try to slam out the car door as hard as you can, it may bounce open. But if you just push it gently, click, just clicks, it's meant to close shut gently. So in the spiritual practice, be gentle in how you're doing it. Now we're giving ourselves a breather. But I don't feel like working out today. I'm gonna work out inside. It's just raw outside here. I'll do a bunch of stuff inside. Yeah, stretching inside. Bosu ball. I'll do the Bosu ball. I've done the roller this morning, balance roller, Bosu ball. I'll do the Bosu ball. I'll hit that hard. That gives your core. It just wipes your core out. Plus, does balance work. and stretching on a yoga mat. I'll do some stretching. But I like doing different stuff. It gets boring if you do the same thing all the time. It does, a little boring. But certain stuff is kind of standard. You go back to it again and again. Trying to stay from falling asleep here. And at some point, the overall practice, you finally just feel like, wow, I really depleted. I just feel tired now in general. So it feels like it's getting towards that at this point. I don't want to overdo it. The warrior will say, no, I got to keep running. I got to keep running, you know. But the pragmatist will say, this has been really, really, really powerful here, and we don't need to overdo it. You know, sometimes we go longer. We want to stretch it out, but it's a fine line. We don't want to try to be proving just how long can we do it. If it happens, it happens. But we're pragmatic. This Sony computer was a great buy. It's lasted for so long. I think I got it in what, 2008 maybe, something. We got it, but it's lasted like almost like 9 years of constant use, super heavy constant use, and still everything works. I mean, the sockets for the audio are getting a little bit fizzy, so it's making some background fizzy noises, but other than that, you know, everything still works. Well, the CD thing doesn't work so good. I guess I abused it or something in some way. But the guts of it, I mean, I'm still using it, the tape, right? So if I got another computer, I'll Sony for sure. Sony was always been a high-end product. I always have gotten Sony if I could in the past of whatever I get. It tends to be, you know, last longer. Japanese made. Well, I don't know, maybe Sony, they make it in China now. It's possible, right? Yeah. But high quality Japanese stuff tends to be very last, you know, like certain Toyota engines, like that was at the R2002 or something. There's some engine, Toyota's bulletproof. It just, you drive it 500,000 miles, you know, it's still going. Stuff like that, it's great value. In terms of, yeah, I want my computer to last at least 10 years, 15 years. But these days, people, you know, new computer every year, they just trade it in, you know, get whatever they do. I don't know what they do. It's just all disposable, you know, super wasteful, bad for the environment, and all that stuff. Always getting new iPhone, new this, you know. No, give me a phone that I want it to last at least 10 years. As a minimum of anything lasting 10 years. Minimum, bare minimum. Camera should last 10 years. The old Japanese cameras, they still work great. The Pentaxes, I mean, if you have one of those, it probably still works. Everything's flawless on it. But shifting over to digital cameras, people got different, you know, cameras. But wow, the old high workmanship in some of the stuff. I used to have Pentax cameras. I never got the Nikons are too expensive, but if you really want to get it, go to Nikon. Good SLR Nikon back in the day. It would still be working just fine right now. That's the way it was. The old Lycra cameras. Some of the top brands, they're still totally functional. And that's the way it should be, right? So you can make stuff totally functional for last for a long time. It's planned obsolescence is what we have done in the world. It's all planned. I've talked to the people who know. So, oh yeah, it only lasts a short time, and then it's going to break. We know that there's parts in there that are going to break, and this encourages you to buy a new one. Okay, I mean, because fixing it's too expensive. It's cheaper to just buy a new one than to fix the old one, even though it's just simple parts that are breaking. People in the appliance industry tell me that. They say that's how everything is now. You can't buy a good appliance anymore. I talked to an appliance man. You can't buy a good appliance anymore. Even the really expensive ones, they have their areas in there that are designed to fail. Designed to fail. Everything we buy is designed to fail. I don't like that. I hate that. I want something that's designed not to fail. Well, peace of God is designed not to fail. The only way it can't fail, we have to abandon it. But it hasn't failed. It's still perfectly. So the peace of God is the ultimate commodity, actually. When we talk about being a commodity-driven world, which we are, then the wisdom in such a world is to accept the peace of God. That's the ultimate commodity. It is designed, it can't fail. It cannot fail. So when you accept it, it's sure to arrive, and it will stay with you flawlessly unless you abandon it. But you can never say, well, I left it because it failed. Oh, it failed me. No, it will never, it doesn't fail. It's the perfect commodity. It's the one commodity designed to free us from all other commodities. You might say that. I don't know if I'll do graphics. Maybe if I'm just bored, you know, I might do some more graphics. I don't know. For what? This is way better than graphics, isn't it? That's kind of a come down to graphics. It's some action to take. But these videos here are way better than graphics. I mean, we're actually doing what is effective, truly effective here. The one commodity that can't fail. So don't say, well, I left it. Well, I'm leaving it because I'm fixing it. No, it never breaks. So you're not fixing it. I'm getting insurance on it. No, it'll never break. So there's no, you don't need insurance on it. I'm buying stuff to fix it when it breaks later on. It never breaks. You don't need to buy stuff to fix it. You see, so all these excuses we're using to leave it. No, we don't leave it. You abandon it. The only way is just you completely abandon it, because there's never any cause for you to leave it at all. There's never a cause to leave the peace of God. It doesn't cause you to leave it under any circumstances. So we need to start being more and more honest here. Says, I've accepted the peace of God. Wow. I've abandoned the peace of God. Wow. Those are the only two conditions we can really find ourselves in, right? Either acceptance of the peace of God or abandonment of the peace of God. Only two conditions. We've narrowed it down to that. So I'm starting to come out of the shock. But I keep putting myself back in. That's the practice. You come out of it, put yourself back in, come out of it, gently put yourself in it, gently pick yourself out of the shock, help yourself out of it through the wow practice. And I'm starting to feel, you know, a little better with it now. But initially, when it hit really hard, really hard. And I even feel like eating something at this point. gotta be careful about that. Go back to the pizza. I ate almost a whole entire half of a pizza. Small pizza, but they're big. It's like 8 pieces. I must have eaten like at least 6 of them, I think. And I told myself I'd eat just one. But don't ever tell yourself you can eat one piece of pizza. That's not honest. I wasn't being honest. It wasn't. I knew. I said, once I get that taste of one pizza, I said, wow, that was so good. I think I'll have another. Very addictive. I torture is getting a full a pizza there, and telling yourself that you're just going to eat one piece and save the rest others for tomorrow, and one piece a day. That's torture. Don't even get the pizza if you're trying to think that way. So when we abandon the peace of God, we've abandoned it, and we're looking for ways to fix it. So I'm being real smart because I got to figure out, you know, how it can break. So it's so wonderful. I don't want to lose it. So I gotta figure out how it can break and what to do when it breaks, how to fix it. So I'm now studying how to fix the peace of God when it breaks. See, this is what happens, right? Exactly what happens. And I've studied many books to figure out how to fix it when it breaks, because it's so wonderful. I can't stand if when it breaks, I won't be able to tolerate that. I'm gonna have to find how to fix it real fast. So I got to be real spiritually smart, know how to fix the peace of God when it breaks. So we're all studying that, and that's the absolute folly that we need to recognize, and we have recognized it here. It never breaks. So we either accept the peace of God or we abandon the peace of God. That's it. So I accept the peace of God. Wow. I've abandoned the peace of God. Wow. Just practice that. There's no fixing. There's no studying to fix anything. So the more we see this, the more we just drop all that strategy of, gee, I'm trying to fix it or trying to insure it or how do I get a new one? I don't know if I can afford a new one. How did I get this one? So when this one breaks, how am I going to get a new one? So then you try to figure out how you got it. So we're blocking all that stuff off, all this mental strategy off. We're just saying, I've accepted the peace of God. Wow. I've abandoned the peace of God. Wow. I've accepted the peace of God. Wow. I've abandoned the peace of God. Wow. And that's it. That's it. This is an entire new area that we've managed to pioneer into right now. Super fruitful. We can feel the fruitfulness of this. We've come upon a fruitful plain right now. Wow. And we have to be sure that we're familiarize ourselves enough with it in this practice here that we could stay here. Say, hey, okay, I'm getting used to it. I'm already getting used to it. The lay of the land. This new territory we're in right now. But it's not terra incognita at this point because we're getting used to it. Oh, okay, so I strategize by saying, how do I get a new one? In other words, how do I get it? So I got to get it again based on the premise it's going to break. And then how do I fix it? Also, if I can't get a new one, how do I fix it? I want to be able to fix it too. So all this preoccupation of the mind is as much ado about nothing because none of that's in play at all. It doesn't break. It's the perfect commodity. It remains working flawlessly for as long as we want it to remain with it. It works flawlessly. And it arrives imperceptibly. When we ask it to arrive, it arrives. And the only way it departs, it doesn't ever depart, but we depart from it. We accept it. Accepting it is our arrival. It's there already. And the only way we can be away from it is abandoning it. That's it. So there's no call to figure out how to get a new one, and there's no call to figure out how to fix it. Fix it, it won't break, it won't deteriorate. We think it might wear out, so we need to get a new one. It never wears out, so we don't need to get a new one. So we don't need to figure out, well, how did I get this one? No, it just arrived. I accepted it. I have the peace of God. There's no way to determine how it arrived. It's imperceptible. It arrived because I gave up the abandonment of it. That's how it arrived. I gave up the abandonment of it. That's how it arrives. And since the leaving of it was my abandonment of it, we realize that it wasn't broken at all. The lie is that it broke. We say, no, I had the peace of God, but something went wrong, it broke. And it never broke at all. So, I accept the peace of God, wow. I abandon the peace of God, wow. I accept the peace of God, wow. It's one dynamic, abandonment or acceptance is this one thing. If we give up the abandonment, that is the acceptance. If we give up the acceptance, that is the abandonment of it, right? We've abandoned it. How are we doing here? Oh, nice. 3-hour taping. Every minute worth it, right? Every minute worth it. This is the intensity that we're into now. And It's just so effective. I wouldn't be doing this if it wasn't so effective. I'd be doing something else. It's so compelling. I don't want to stop because it's so effective what we're looking at now. It's just historically effective what we're doing here. Of course I understand that. This is, it's like a musician. If you come up with something and you realize, oh, this is great music. If you came up with the disco beat, like the Bee Gees, they came up with their sound. They knew that they had a sound. Dion, the doo-wop, he knew he had a sound. He knew, said, this, wow, this is going to hit. This is a real sound. Beatles, they knew they had a sound. Beach Boys, they knew they had a sound. A historic sound that you come across it and you say, wow, this is going to fly. And you know it. So this is historic stuff we're doing here. This is going to fly. I'm aware of that. Wow. Historic stuff, wow. Non-historic stuff, 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 wow. So I'm willing to do these longer tapings. It's just when you're in the studio and you find the sound, you're going to tape an album. You got that sound going. You say, wow, let's do a bunch of songs. I mean, we have found our sound right now. Sometimes they pop out like a lot of albums per year because the sound sells, people love it, and they put out a lot. And then eventually people, it fades on them. Musical tastes fade. We think the peace of God will fade. It's not, and it won't fade. It's not something that fades like musical taste. So we don't have to say, okay, I'm just searching for the next best thing. No, this is the final best thing. This is the perfect commodity. Peace of God is the perfect commodity, the perfect final condition. Imaginary condition. So we don't abandon it to go shopping saying, okay, this is great, but I'm going to tire of it, it'll get boring, so I'm now looking for the next fashion. People go out, what are they doing? What are so many people doing right now? They're in the mall looking for the next fashion. They most certainly are. I have great fashion without hardly even trying. That's a talent. It's accepting what you're wearing. The best fashion is you're comfortable with what you're wearing. Okay, that's high fashion, actually. You're confident and comfortable in what you're wearing. It works. That's a lot to do with it. So I don't go out to stores and seek for fashion. I used to. I was a fashionista for a while, to say the least. I went through that phase. I put myself through that phase. I wanted to see what it was like, because I knew that the fashion choices coming in the world were just going to be crazy, inundated, and the cycles would get more and more. So I wanted to get through with it before it got really bad. So I did, but I was a super fashionista. I go into stores and just try stuff on all day. I didn't have the money to buy. I might buy a few things, get into credit problem, ran up, credit problems, debt problems, doing that. But I would go in and try on, 10, just so much stuff. Just try it on, look in the mirror and say, how do I look? Let me try this shirt, let me try this, and then return it and say, well, and then let me try something else. So I was able to just put on the Ritz, as a fashionista, you go into, you know, you go into all different types of stores, try on all sorts of different clothes. And so one day you can hit like 20 stores or something, and well, that's quite a few. Let's say 10. And just like you've been wearing all the styles of both today and yesterday, and retro stuff, you know, all different types of things. Which itself was pretty shocking, profound practice. Just, you see so many different superficial use by just changing, completely changing your fashion, maybe hundreds of times a day. I used to do that. Hundreds of times a day I would change my fashion. Had, you know, hundreds of different hats. You could put on all different types of hats and shoes. All different, everything. Now women can do it even more with all the handbags and the shawls, and they just have more jewelry and accessories and stuff. But I try to just use pretty much everything too. You know, just as much as you can of just whatever fashion, you know. Yeah, just use anything. If you're a real fashionista, you will just use anything. You can put on a wig. You put on wigs. That really blows your mind. You put on wigs. Women know that, right? They put on a different wig. They're very good. Women are very skillful at being fashionistas. But men can do it too. Put on wigs and jewelry and everything. It's like, what is that? You know, it's like a completely different me. It's like 100 makeovers a day. If you're into it, don't restrict yourself to one gender's clothing or accessories at all. You don't have to. It's just like there's a different me. Like, what is this? It's completely changed. And then you just change and you're completely something different. And then change again and you're, you know, it's completely different. It's like, and you can do that hundreds of times, 100 different changes a day, every day, as I did, every day for like years. You go through tens of thousands of different looks. And it's just like, and finally you just say, wow, this isn't the peace of God. I mean, it's still not the ultimate thing, is it? Being a fat, but now, you know, it can really become such an obsession because there's so much constantly changing. You go into any store, they've changed everything every time. Like, you know, it's just, you can't keep up with it. So you feel buried. I had so many clothes. It's just, you can't imagine how many clothes I had. And eventually, as soon as I got rid of all of them, basically, then it was just back to real simple stuff. T-shirt and a sweater, a pair of sweats, and some tennis shoes. That's also great fashion. But yeah, you put all the robes, all the pageantry, you know, you can find stuff in specialty stores, novelty stores, all different types of stores, clothing stores. Halloween, you go Halloween, you can put on, like, go for Halloween, you try on all these different costume stores. And there's costume stores all year round. You can go in and you can just dress up in all these different ways. But I always tried to buy something so that, you know, they realized that you weren't just using them. I would buy stuff, yeah. So I kept it fair, but unfortunately, it caused me to go into debt. Paid a price for that. But I always tried to patronize, you know, and not just use them that way. But while you're patronizing them, get, you know, make sure you know, if you're gonna buy a pair of shoes, go in and try on like 100 shoes before you buy that pair of shoes. And women know that. They do that on purpose, of course. They're very savvy about all this stuff. They know they're gonna buy a pair of shoes. They know that their budget is. But they'll act like they might buy 100 pairs. Say, this is about, you know, try, and they're really just trying everything on, looking themselves in the mirror and say, how do I look like this? And they go, how do I look like this? How do I look like that? And they can do that all day. And then they finally say, you know what? This is the pair. And the clerks know this game. You know, it's like, oh God, okay. Let me know if you find something and I can help you. But their hope they're hoping you'll buy more than one pair. And sometimes, if you're not really savvy, you'll end up buying too much, and then you get in debt. So fashionistas have a real, shoppers have a real danger of getting into severe debt. And now it's too difficult. It's too dangerous right now. Too dangerous. I already had that problem. I don't even go into stores anymore. I don't. I just order online. If I need, just order online. One thing, that's it. It's too dangerous now. Because they've gotten so slick. I mean, like GNC. I went to a store. I've never seen this before. A whole drugstore with huge GNC section. And the marketing, the skill in packaging is really extraordinary in marketing. Oh, they're so slick. I was looking at everything. What in the heck is going on here? I had never seen this before. Because I don't go into stores, basically, anymore. And I saw how slick their packaging and marketing is. I said, oh, wow. That is dangerous stuff. And I was picking up package and looking at it. I said, man, maybe I should get this. You know, and I'd read the ingredients, you know. Green coffee bean extract, you know, caffeine guarana extract, creatine, you know, tons of creatine. And all. And it's like, no. I mean, that's messing with your chemistry. All that stuff really messes with your chemistry. Stay away from that stuff. I didn't buy anything, but it was tempting. The way that they're marketing it, that you feel like, you know, hey, I could be like Superman. This is how I become Superman. Dangerous, dangerous. The skill in packaging now is really extraordinary. Wow, it's like space age material. You know, the way they present it and everything. It's like you think you're getting something really special, that's going to change your life. So. Marketing package is huge part of commodity culture. Huge part of it. And it's too tempting. Now it's too tempting. You got to know your limits. Yeah, really. Understand. Be humble. Humble enough to not shop. And I'm humble enough to not shop. I don't go. That's why it's dangerous for your wife to have a credit card. It's like playing Russian roulette. You said, man, you know, at some point they're going to start spending. They spend all their times in stores. A lot of them can't resist. They think they can play the game. They think they're these fashionistas, but down inside they're very vulnerable to the marketing, because the marketers are constantly seeking new ways to seduce them. So everyone has their Waterloo, you know. Even the top women fashionistas have their Waterloo. And before you know it, they've plunged into debt again. So the best advice is stay out of stores, shop on the internet. That's what I do. Wow. Even though I have all this resistance, it's still too dangerous. So see, wisdom is just stay away from it. Even though I have, like I said, I've had so much experience, I also have had experience, you know, falling. So I know that you can fall, and you will fall. If you keep flirting with it, you will fall. If you keep flirting around, you're going to fall. You know, I fooled around and fell in love, Elvin Bishop. You fool around with enough partners, you're going to fall. Okay, you think, no, I'm just shopping, I'm just, you know, window shopping and trying out different this and that, different costumes, really, special relationships, they're just a costume, like you're trying out. I wonder how I'd be with this costume. You're going to fall, for sure, you will fall. So just stay away from it. That's real wisdom. If you don't want to fall, then just stay away from temptation. It's that simple. And you know, you get burned, and you have a terrible experience, and you think you've repented, but The people, if they keep going back, they're going to fall again. They're fooling themselves. They're not humble enough. It's scary. Very scary. And then you're supposed to be responsible for that? That's not right. Anyone that says they won't fall again is a liar. They're the very ones that will fall. They haven't learned their lesson. It's like an alcoholic that says, well, I can manage my drinking. I just have to learn how to do it. I just didn't know before. I just didn't have the skills other people are managing successfully, so I'll be able to manage successfully. And so they go back and boom, they fall again. They found their weak spot. Everyone has a weak spot. When you find your weak spot, stay away from it. Now, the people that can manage their drinking, that's not their weak spot. But they have some other weak spot. Maybe it's shopping. Maybe it's gambling. You know, maybe it's something else, right? So they have their weak spot they have to stay away from. Just stay away from it. If your weak spot's alcohol, you don't drink. You just stay away from it, plain and simple. You don't test yourself. So just letting the shock settle here. The shock is still there, just letting it settle a little bit. It's like a heavy rain. The rain's still, you can see puddles everywhere, but you know, it's sinking in and it's evaporating, and then next couple days you go around, it's like, oh, you know, hard to even know there was a storm at all. It's the water's gone, most of the water's gone. A few puddles still around, yeah. It dries out fast in California. What a winter we've had. So extraordinary. I hope people didn't plant their gardens yet. I mean, most people put them in. You would say they'd be putting them in, but not with this storm. Not with this. It will stunt them. So really, late planting this year in Cal. Really late is the wise way. I haven't planted anything. I don't know if I will. But wisely, not the right time to plant. This storm here, really, plants go into shock. You know, you don't want to plant when it stunts them. So you want to make sure when things are planted that they're not going to be thrown into shock. So we may have to wait till May or late April to plant this year. I mean, good grief. You know, other years, we had tomatoes before the end of May. Beautiful tomatoes before the end of May. I planted like at the end of February. There are sometimes you could have planted earlier than that. I was being cautious. So March, April, May. I mean, March, April, you'd have tomatoes in May for sure. The 60-day ones, you know, maybe middle of May. But now you may have to wait for May to plant. So you have, in July, you have tomatoes in July now. Some years were so mild here, I had impatiens all year round, which are very delicate. Never stopped blooming all year round. Never didn't have to plant them. They just kept all through the winter. We didn't even have any cold spell at all here in the wintertime. But this winter, we've had everything. We've had everything. This is a rugged winter, to say the least. And the world, maybe we're headed towards a rugged time, right? A rugged time in the old western town here. So part of the practice here is just letting it settle in, let the water sink into the ground. That's familiarity. Let the stay connected with the practice. Stay connected. You're just letting the overall inner land, the inner landscape of our clarity, the landscape of our clarity, and call it inner. It's both inner and outer. It's just the landscape of our clarity. We're getting used to it. Say, oh, this is new territory. I haven't seen this before. Wow. Don't be in a hurry to leave it. This is wisdom. You see people, wise, common sense people, they go into a new area, new space. They kind of just hang around. They're not in any hurry. They're just getting used to it because they want to return. I mean, they say, oh, I like this place. I don't want to be rushing. They linger on. They linger there. They're not on to the next party, the next place. Some after a round of golf, a lot of golfers, they go in, have some food, have some drink, and they stay there for another couple hours. They want that to sink in, the experience to sink in. They don't want to rush home. Of course, getting out of the home may be the whole purpose of it in the first place. They're in no hurry to get back home. So we're not in a hurry here. Cannot be in a hurry in that way. We're in a hurry in that we're desperate enough to practice every day. That's our hurry. But within that, we're not in a hurry in our daily practice. But the fact that we're practicing every day means we're in a tremendous rush to get the peace of God. Tremendous rush. But within the daily practice, we linger like this. We linger with it. The intensity is still reverberating. No question about it. I feel it. Wow. These are not small potatoes. You know, this is very, very profound. We're getting a feel for the peace of God. This whole issue is becoming very, very clear to us. And this is our goal. So our goal is becoming very, very clear to us. This is very significant. So we feel the significance of it. We feel it. So we respect that. We're not in a hurry to abandon that. Not in a hurry to abandon it. It'd be nice if the day got a little warmer, but it's not really trending that way too much. I hurt my knee at the beach because I was getting too enthused about it. And God was telling me, okay, this is great, what we're doing is great, but you need to start now turning towards reaching the goal, okay? And so from that point on, every time I went to the beach, my knees just was killing me. It was hurting so bad. And so it was just God's way of saying, you know, it's time now to really focus in again on your practicing. Get back to the grind of this, doing this right, and succeed with it. Will I ever go to the beach again? I don't know. Really, I really don't know if it'll ever happen again. I try not to think about it. Just like the leaving golf. I mean, will I ever golf again? I don't know. But right now, it's more important to look at this dynamic of this peace of God, right? How do I get a new one when it wears out, and how do I fix it when it breaks? And you know, those are all excuses, right? Continuity fear excuses, familiarity fear excuses. Be honest and be aware of it so we don't get lost in that stuff. And again, it's a western, and the new sheriff in town, and it's going to be a shooting town now. See, the racketeers are in trouble. Elliot Ness has come, and Al Capone is in trouble. Right? The bootleggers are in trouble. And so they're, you know, trying to massage public opinion. I mean, the bootleggers had tremendous... The racketeers have all sorts of politicians in their pockets. You got to understand this. That's how it works. So you got all these politicians lobbying really for the racketeers. Saying, hey, folks, you know, this isn't right. What's going on? This new sheriff's terrible. You know, trying to get the public to turn against the new sheriff. You got that going on big time right now. So many corrupt politicians. So much corruption going on through all this money trying to, you know, keep it going, status quo, and keep the racketeering spreading stronger and stronger. So they line the pockets of many as they can. And they're the ones screaming and complaining the loudest are the ones who've had their pockets lined, for sure. They're, you know, the gravy train is about to end for them, so of course they're squealing. Unbelievable corruption we've had in this country, in the United States. So much so that we decided we can't trust any politicians at all. I brought in a businessman instead of a politician. We simply cannot trust politicians. They are so corrupt. They have become so corrupt by lobbyists of every type, special interests of every type, racketeering of every type, all sorts of different types of racketeering going on. Legally, you know, supposedly, right? In every which way. And so the public just said, you know, we cannot trust you. Your approval rating is like zero to us. So we'll get a new sheriff, a real tough businessman, no nonsense, shooting sheriff come in to clean it up. Same thing they did in the Philippines. And I think people are shocked by how corrupt the Philippines have become and how pervasive drug abuse have become in that country. I mean, I was shocked. I didn't know about that. It's super bad. The corruption had reached the top. The top. I mean, the head of the prisons in the country was the one getting all the kickbacks from all the drug pushers. The ones running all the prisons. The head of the criminal justice system was, or something like that, really top, super top, top, top potential president, candidate for president, was apparently, allegedly, receiving massive kickbacks from all the drug pushers. Yeah, so it was just unbelievable corruption in the Philippines. And you got a strong man in there to clean it up. And people, you know, a lot of people are crying about it because they didn't think it would reach them. You know, their gravy train is getting cut too. It's like, ah. So marks the spirit of the times of, you know, crackdown on corruption. That won't last forever. Corruption will come back. Always does. Always does, doesn't it? So the morality play continues on. Later on, you know, the racketeers creep back in. They're very good at creeping back in. Very cleverly get a hold on the culture again. And the whole thing repeats itself. But right now, we've got a shooting sheriff in town. And he knows who the bad guys are. You know, he's able to tell, you know, who they are easily. And no mercy for them. So it's that time where we need to be really focused here on our practice. No nonsense. I know it. I mean, the Holy Spirit said, hey, you got to get after it now, all in. Because this isn't going to change. I mean, the shooting is going to get more and more. I mean, it's going to get this summer's. I've been warned. Look out. racketeers will make their play. I mean, the racketeers don't go down easily, right? No, they go down guns blazing. Thuggery is all they know. They don't know another life. The bosses may sneak off somewhere, and try to avoid it getting fingered, but the thugs, they don't know any life other than that. So thugs are going to be thugs. Go down in a place of thuggish glory or vainglory. That's how it is in the world, this world. The mind trying to imagine conditions for itself. Play of evaluation, the insecurity of hallucination. It's hell. This world is hell. So that's how it is in hell. But we can have the peace of God even in hell. And it's the perfect commodity, it's the perfect condition. It never, the bloom is never off that rose of peace of God. It's a flower that's ever fresh, remains ever fresh and beautiful and full of scent and full of all lovely characteristics and never fades, never fades. It's okay, it never fades, never fades away. There's no pestilence that can touch it. There's no rust that can touch it. No maintenance required. No maintenance required. So we don't need a bunch of money for it. To maintain it, to protect it, no protection required. It's invulnerable. It's just, it has no vulnerability, but our vulnerability is abandoning it. But if we give up abandoning it, we've got it permanently without doing anything else. Talk about a great setup, huh? Perfect. Oh, it's getting windy again. Must be another little thunderstorm coming in. Thunderstorms push this turbulence in front of them. So a lot of thunderstorms coming for the world in terms of turbulence. The sheriff is seeking out all sorts of pockets of corruption. I mean, there's going to be likely quite a bit of turmoil, as I've telling everyone, please get to this practice. It wouldn't listen. Most won't listen. So I'm not going to beat my head against the wall. If people won't listen, I'll back off. I'm not going to waste my time with those not listening. I couldn't get anywhere on Facebook. Couldn't get anywhere. At least here, that there are those that are listening. I mean, if you're on Facebook, you can post these videos. You can share these videos on Facebook. If you want us here, if you want to stay on Facebook, okay. If you're not, but how do you use it, your time in a wise way? Share these videos on your Facebook page, on your timeline, on your page. Share it, share it, share it, share it. Share the stuff I make available on Facebook. If you're going to stay on Facebook, that's a no-brainer. Bring more people to watching these videos. If you want to be useful, if you want to take action, that's wise action to take, because we have the remedy here. We're really dialed in. Very much so. But I'm not going to go on back on Facebook now. I have to make these materials available to everyone. So I don't know. I don't know if anyone's ever shared any of these videos on Facebook. Never shared them. There's a button right beneath the video. It says share. You just share it to your Facebook page. And if I make graphics available, like on a blog or something, share it to Facebook. If you are on Facebook. If you're not, don't go on there. Okay? Don't get the habit. Okay, don't get the habit. We looked at it. We said, nah, no. But if you do have the habit, then just make a habit of sharing all the material that I'm giving out on Facebook. Just make that your posting. And that'll keep you involved with what we're doing here, okay? And maybe you'll comment on it. Maybe you'll make a comment like, I really love this video. I really highly advise everyone to watch this video. I really feel this is the answer. Do that. Be proactive in that way. But I've done everything I can do to try to be proactive on Facebook. It takes a lot of people doing that, not just one. Just one, they just ignore it. But if you get a whole bunch of people doing that, you might start a movement towards paying attention. You might be part of that. So yeah, let me advise that at this point, at this moment, if you're already addicted to Facebook, this is some way to work your addiction, trend it back towards right practice, right? Absolutely. Okay, how are we doing? Wow, I'm still in the wow of this, you know, just as expected. But the lack of proactivity is amazing. Maybe that's by design. The Holy Spirit said you weren't ready for it yet. But it's certainly doable. Certainly doable in some way. I don't know how to share photos. I mean, maybe a blog. I put photos on a blog and say share this to Facebook. But nobody visits the blog. That's not very helpful at all, is it? I could put them on a website, but a blog is free. I can't afford to pay for a website. Blog is free, unlimited amounts. You can put as many pictures, a lot of pictures up there. People could post those to Facebook. But linking, sharing the videos and saying something about them, maybe you'll get people's attention. They'll start watching them, and that'll wean them away from Facebook, the overaction there, and lack of depth, not the right structure, not the right way to go about it. Well, probably enough. Whew, I don't want to get too chilled here. And so we're moving towards wrapping this up. I don't feel like moving at all right now. I feel pretty stunned by it all. This is what happens. You don't feel like taking action. When a successful practice, afterwards, you don't really feel like doing anything. You kind of got the blahs. Later on, maybe the day, I'll feel like working out. I'll do that. But not right now. I may just go eat something. Or I don't know, take a rest. Or I don't know what I'll do. But you feel like, wow, this. I just feel like sitting quietly. This has changed my whole destiny. You know, this practice really changed it. So it takes a while for your mind just to get used to a new destiny path. It really does. I feel like eating some crackers, but that puts weight on. Salty crackers. Yeah. I like really salty crackers. I don't have them, but I used to eat saltines. I love saltines. They're so salty. Just these white soda crackers with a lot of salt granules. Saltines. No nutritional value, but they got salt on them. Salty peanuts is really good too. Love salty, salty peanuts, but they got a lot of calories, peanuts. I'll try salty peanut butter right now. I'll sprinkle a whole bunch of salt on peanut butter on a salty cracker. Or I could put, sometimes I just take a handful of peanuts and just pour a bunch of salt on my hand and just, you know, eat the peanuts with the salt. That's very effective too. My system is really shocked. I can feel the shock in my system from the great success we've had here. That's this practice. You have to realize that inaction, be committed to inaction, have a very inactive life. It's really helpful. I have a very inactive life. My job keeps me active on the weekdays, but driving to and fro. But in terms of my overall life, I got no friends, I got nothing to do, so I just sit in my room all weekend, and it's fine. I'm fine with that. I don't have to do anything. There's nobody calling me up to do anything. Is this free of the shawl? No, it's not. No. I got no action. Nothing I need to do. Not shopping. Not going anywhere. Nothing. I just sit in my room. Which is what I've done most of my life. Which shows, you know, how fruitful that has been. Very, very fruitful. Monastic life is really super intense. It's the most intense life there is. People think that going to a monastic life is terrible. No, it's more intense than any other type of life. Because you're having success, and you're having to manage that success, and you're in shock, and you're just, it's just, you got your hands full with the success. And it's just amazing. Way better than an ordinary life, monastic life. Properly done. If it just becomes stale and robotic, then that's no good at all. Okay, I'm going to freeze here if I don't get this. Very great. Wow, right? We're in the wow west right now, right? The wow west.